Greetings, metal minions. This is George. You're about to experience the field recordings and interviews that we made while out and about at GWARBQ 2015. I am going to intersperse the interviews here and there throughout the episode, so you will hear me pop up to introduce them occasionally. But before we get into the episode, I want to take a moment and thank my metal brothers, Buke and Will, for making the day an extremely fun time. I also want to thank everyone we met and talked to and interviewed. It was truly a pleasure. All right, put on your seatbelts and let's get started. Good morning, metalheads. This is George.
This is Buke.
And this is Will.
And we are on 95 South heading towards Richmond for the 2015 GWARBQ Festival at Haddad Lake. How are you gentlemen this morning?
I'm doing wonderful. I'm very little sleep, but I'm fucking excited.
We hit the road. Well, you hit the road earlier than I did because you came to pick me up, but I hit the road at 6 a.m. So I know you're tired. Will, how you doing?
I'm doing excellent, gentlemen. I got a little more sleep than you guys did.
Right on. So, I hate to admit it, but Buke had a good idea. You know, we started off this morning, and last year we hit a hell of a lot of traffic on the way to GWARBQ. It took us like 5 hours to get to Richmond. And since we are leaving the morning of as opposed to the evening before, the first bands start at 10 o'clock this morning. So we were like, what if we hit some traffic? And Buke's like, oh, we'll just take the 95 express lane and bypass a bunch of traffic. And I was like, nah, you're crazy, man. You know, that doesn't go far enough. Well,
there is no 95 express lanes, to quote you.
Yes, well, I meant after, you know, for the majority of the drive, which I am correct about. However, it does appear to be saving us from a bit of traffic outside the D.C. area, so I will eat a little crow and admit that he was right about that. Although, if you look over at the regular lanes, they are moving right now. But still, it was pretty shitty a minute ago, so. All right. So, what are you looking forward to today, Mr. Buke?
First band I'm looking forward to, Down, number one band. As soon as they were announced, I knew the rest of the bill could,
fuck off.
In a sense. And every band that was announced since then, Troglodyte, Goatwhore, Valkyrie, Mutoid Man, just sweeten that pot.
Hell yeah. What about you, Will?
I'm going to go with the Cro-Mags. I have not seen the Cro-Mags in probably 25 years, maybe, on their Best Wishes tour. Saw them up in Allentown, Pennsylvania, and I loved it, and I love that album, and I hope they just play that entire album, which they probably won't.
But anyone else?
Yeah, I definitely want to see Goatwhore. I have not seen them in a long time. And Valkyrie, just got into those guys. Really digging their sound.
Yeah, Valkyrie's pretty awesome. I'm looking forward to that, too. I'm also looking forward to Goatwhore. I don't think, seen them before. They were supposed to be at GWARBQ last year, and they, like, their vehicle broke down or something, and they didn't show up. And
A duh clutch.
Yeah, definitely want to see Clutch.
And of course, Gwar.
That's right. I forgot they were playing at GWARBQ.
I remember last year, as we were driving down, Gwar was always that band that, you know, they had always toured, and they always seemed to come around every year, every couple years. But they're always that band. Yeah, I'll see him next time. But with Brocky's untimely death, that's why we went last year. I remember them coming on stage and just laughing the whole time. Not because they're, you know, a joke or anything, but because they're fun to watch. It's a fun set. Their stage presence is cool. It's just fun to watch them, so.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it goes without saying that we all want to see Gwar, so. But I also, like I said, I wanted to see Goatwhore. I haven't seen them before. I'm really looking forward to the Descendants, the part of the punk contingent today. I've never seen them before, And so that would be quite interesting to me. Who else? Was Valkyrie?
Ghoul.
Yeah, I don't really know Ghoul.
Troglodyte,
I really want to see. I'm guessing that between them and Goatwhore, they're probably one of the heaviest bands of the day. I forget who else is playing, though.
That's bands like Stonecutters. People we don't know, really. Stonecutters, RPG.
I guess I want to see Down. Of course I want to see Down. I'm just fucking with you. Anyway... All right, well...
Fucking a day of drinking, hanging with friends. Fucking Will is here.
Yeah, that is probably the best part of today. No offense to Buke. I mean, Buke is like my left arm, so it's of course he's there.
Yes.
You know, that's like a given. That's just like wanting to see Gwar. But having Will along is like icing... It's like fucking jizz on the cake. It's fucking badass. God, so,
you eat.
What's that?
Traffic again.
Ah, yeah, traffic again. All right. Pompous, fuck me.
Ringworm, American Sharks.
American Sharks will be cool.
Down, the Dickies, Ghoul, Mutoid Man, Childlight.
Oh, Mutoid Man, that was another one.
Cutters, Goatwhore, MC Chris, Cancer Bats, Valkyrie. Oh,
Cancer Bats will be cool.
Gritter. It's like gloomy glitter or something.
And, you know, last year we had the Gwar Kilsner was prevalent. This year it's going to be the odorous ale. So
ask Will the question that we were wondering coming down.
Which one
is
was
it,
that?
Is it, Will, do you have any inside knowledge? Is this the same? Did they brew a different beer this year than last year? Did they just change the name and it's the same beer from last year? Do you know?
Since you're a brewer, you must know it all.
Actually, I don't know. I have no idea because I didn't know if Cigar City was going to do it again. So I didn't know if it was going to be so. If they were going to do it again, and if so, was Cigar City, which is down in Tampa, Florida, if they were going to brew the beer again? I'm not sure. I'm not sure, to be honest. Last year's Kilsner, which sounds like Pilsner, was actually an ale, so it wasn't a lager. And so this year they're saying it's, I guess, odorous ale. So it could be the same beer, and I don't remember enough of what the first Gwar beer was the first year that they did it. Last year was the Kilsner. I've had both of them and they were different beers, so I imagine it's going to be a different beer.
All right, well, it could be far worse than having the same beer again. I mean, you know, last year's beer was tasty enough for me. It was, you know, certainly a step above a Budweiser.
Now, one of the complaints we had last year is its stuff sold out. Like what, 1-2 o'clock or something, maybe 3? It was done pretty early.
Yeah, well, I don't know if you saw this, but I saw a release that said they're guaranteeing that they will not run out of beer this time. So, granted, you know, this is unlike probably any other show that I've been to in that it starts early and it ends early. You know, most concerts, they run until dark and, like, at least 11 o'clock. And we were out of there last year before dark. Because Gwar goes on at like 7 or something like that.
No, it ends at 7.
It ends at 7. All right, so there you go. It ends at 7. So that's a little unusual, but at the same time, it's kind of cool because we got a, you know, good like 3-hour drive back, 2.5 maybe if we're lucky. So, you know, we might actually get home before midnight. So,
we're going to get home around 2 o'clock in the morning because we're going to go to the Gwar bar afterwards.
Okay, then. That works, too.
The Gwar bar is very, very small. I've been there once. It's extremely cool. I love the place. It's like one of my meccas. But having a GWARBQ in Richmond and the Gwar bar being in Richmond, I'm pretty sure the Gwar bar is going to have a line out the door. So
today.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I can't imagine we'll actually be able to get into the place.
It's tiny. It's like a small corner bar. It's not very big at all.
Well, there's probably another bar or two in Richmond we could hit if we absolutely had to.
Richmond has some of the best beer bars in the world. They have Mekong, which is a Vietnamese restaurant with a craft beer problem, and then they just opened up. The owner An just opened up a brew pub. I think real close to it or right next to it. called Answer, like Answer, and it's supposedly great. I had one beer from it, and it was really great. So there are lots of things to see, eat, and drink in Richmond. It's a great town, and plus the million breweries that are in Richmond. So if you stick with me, we may be able to get free beer.
Right on. Well, I know last time getting anything at the GWARBQ last year was immensely difficult because there were so many people and the lines were so long. I mean, I think I waited in line like 45 minutes for a cheeseburger. And so obviously we didn't eat much during the day. And so when we left, we had to go find something to eat. So this seems like a good opportunity to try and track one of these places down afterwards. However, this year, wow, look at that fucking traffic. this year, however, in an attempt to deal with this problem, I suppose.
These don't exist again?
Fuck me. Fuck me.
I just like the look on Buke's face. He's like, it's the biggest I told you so.
He's the shit-eating grin of satisfaction on his face. He's just like, I'm right, you're wrong, fuck you. But anyway, in this year, in trying to deal with the situation last year, I mean, you had to wait a long time to take a leak. You had to wait a long time to get something to eat. You had to wait a long time to get beer, which, of course, then eventually ran out. So this year, they've got what they've called the Express Band. And for $19, you can buy the Express Band, and it supposedly gives you access to much shorter lines all across the board. Even, you know, getting into the GWARBQ last year was a long line of waiting. So supposedly you get to jump that line and you get express access to bathrooms, beer, and food.
What happens if everybody buys that express pass? Because I know the three of us have it.
Sold out.
Did it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I was waiting for it to sell out because there's a limited number of them. So it was like, get them while you can. And so I jumped on mine you know, last night there was a bit of a kerfluffle, but Buke couldn't find his email to print his out. Was ultimately resolved, and I was going to just be like, buy another one, but because I didn't think they'd sold out. Sold out. All right.
Yeah, I think the only way I got my Express Pass is I had to get one of those combo tickets where you get the ticket, the Express Pass, and the T-shirt.
Oh, yeah.
So my wife's going to be really excited for me to have yet another concert T-shirt.
Yeah, I actually got the GWARBQ T-shirt last year, and it was white and kind of dorky looking. And I was like, all right, well, maybe I'll wear this. And my wife was like, you're not leaving the house with that thing on, fat boy. So yeah. She didn't say it
George's
quite so.
Wife, George's wife dressed him today.
She did not, actually. I dressed myself. Whoa. Thank you very much. I just got, this is my first wearing of my new total nerddom T-shirt. It's a picture of Darth Vader with a flying V guitar, and it says, I find your lack of heavy metal disturbing.
So where did you get that T-shirt? Because I want one.
eBay.
Ah, nice.
Yeah.
Do they make them smaller sizes?
they do.
You can make five shirts from the scraps of that one.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah. There were actually variations, because these are just people printing them. It's probably illegal, you know, to be using Darth Vader's image.
An officially licensed Star Wars stuff?
Exactly. But, you know, they had them like where like the text was on the side and it was different. I liked this one because the text was on the top and then the picture.
Yeah, but seriously, what size is that? Because I have one of my best friends, Steve Angelucci, is a huge Star Wars nerd like I am and heavy metal nerd. So he would love that shirt besides me. And he's about your size. So
he's huge. This is a 3X.
Okay.
I think it went up to 4, maybe even 5X.
Of course it does.
I said, of course it does.
Yeah.
The Star Wars community is not small.
No.
Now, here's a question.
I say I'm a huge fan, it has a double meaning.
Now, who is the heavier crowd? Star Wars fans or Trekkies?
God. I think they probably balance. On the seesaw of nerddom, they probably...
And there's some nerd out there now saying, well, the atmosphere on this planet, on Dagobah, a Trekkie would weigh less than a Star Wars fan.
I have an answer for this. So I am not bi-sci. I do not follow both Star Wars and Star Trek.
What?
I'm pure Star Wars. I'm a huge fan.
At least you went the right way.
Well, yes, of course. The Force is strong with this one. I think Star Trek fans have a tendency to be way more into some of the minutiae of it, and it's more of a theory. Like, they love the overall theory of this kind integrated universe, and everybody in search of humanity and do no harm and all that stuff. Where Star Wars is just like a bunch of shit blowing up and blasters and spaceships and fights and tongue in cheek, quick quotes. And
Star Trek is for the thinking man.
Yeah, kind of. And Star Wars is to be, there's a lot to think about in Star Wars about the what is it, the mono something theory, which is like the
monomyth.
Yeah, the monomyth, which is the one protagonist who kind of goes throughout this personal journey, which is supposed to be Luke Skywalker and all that stuff. Anyway, so that's my explanation. I think Star Wars is just cooler. And if you are that into Star Trek, you're a bigger nerd. Like, everyone likes Star Wars because it's cool. If you really like Star Trek, you're just really into super nerdy stuff.
Well, I like how you termed it bi-sci. I am totally bi-sci. I love them both, but if I have to go one way or the other, hands down, it's Star Wars.
Good answer.
I just want to note that Buke can stop smiling now, because those express lanes just ended half an hour after picking up Will, and we are now stuck in traffic.
But they existed.
Yes, they probably did save us a little bit of time, but now we're looking at it like arriving around lunchtime after the first four or five bands, because it's
why is this here? Why does this exist?
Because everybody's going on vacation. It's go to the beach morning. It's because people probably just are like, I got nothing better to do. Let's go out and wreck somebody's day by parking on 95. Who fucking knows?
The thing is that gets me, I know it's volume, and I hear I'm bitching about traffic. Like, people haven't heard this exciting podcasting here. But why? Why are we crawling along at fucking 20?
Yeah, I don't know.
We're on the fucking highway.
The highway, not the fucking go-nowhere way. But at least we have each other.
Let me ask you this. Will, have you seen Down before? Or have you even seen, more importantly, Gwar before?
Yeah, I've seen Gwar a bunch of times. I think the first time I saw them was probably 1993. When I was stationed at Camp Lejeune in North Carolina, there was a place called The Monk, which was down in Wilmington, and I went down there and actually took a bunch of guys from my platoon who were not into heavy music at all. But I said, it doesn't matter. This is theater. It is heavy metal theater. So you got to go. And they loved it. Every single person I've taken to a Gwar show, almost every time I've seen them, I've taken somebody who's not into heavy metal. Like, I took my old roommate Doug one time. And he just thought it was the most brilliant thing he's ever seen in his life. So I've definitely seen Gwar probably four or five times over the years. A couple times at the 930 Club in D.C. I'm pretty sure I saw him in Philly at the Trocadero one time. And I've been to the GWARBQ, but I went to the year that it was canceled at the Lakes. I think it was the second year. Mm. And they moved it to the State Theater or something in downtown Richmond at the last minute.
Okay.
But it was not the same experience, because it's driving. Am I going to drive all the way 2 hours down to Richmond to go see Gwar in a concert hall? Probably not, because they come around the DC enough. But will I drive down? Will I get escorted down and chauffeured down for 2 hours in traffic in a Prius with my two good buddies to see them outdoor at a big festival? Oh, hell yeah, I am.
So you haven't been to Haddad Lake yet?
No, I have not.
Well, sir, if we ever get there, you're in for a treat.
No, this is going to be awesome. It's going to be, I checked, it's going to be about high 80s, 90 degrees all day, sunny, not a chance of rain. So it'll be hot and humid, but no rain. We got sunscreen, we got sunglasses, we got a half a pack of cigarettes.
Full pack, actually.
Yeah, okay.
And you know, there's always odorous ale. And apparently they're giving away free guater. So they're as good as Gene Simmons, man. They are branded everything.
So to let listeners know, one of the ways that I got actually hooked up with your podcast is because last year when you guys go in the GWARBQ, me being a connoisseur of beer, especially a collector of heavy metal beer, I told you guys, please bring me back some GWAR beer. And you guys said, if we bring back GWAR beer and we can smuggle it out of there, then you have to come on the podcast. And I said, deal. But here's my question. How did you smuggle it out?
We didn't actually smuggle it from the show itself. We were staying at a Hampton Inn nearby because we were there Friday for the Odorous Memorial. And we found out that the Holiday Inn? That was like two hotels down from us, they were serving it in the bar. You could go in and buy four packs. And so we stumbled over there at like 1 o'clock in the morning and we were like, and bought like, we each got a four pack of some of the last ones that they had. And so that is how we were able to bring it back. Today, I'll be happy to drink the beer, but I would like to at least be able to get a can out of there somehow. So...
Yeah, I definitely need the can, at least the can, to add to my heavy metal bottle can collection that I have at the brewery. But I know there's a ton of people who love beer and metal who will want some of this, so I need to see how my smuggling skills are today.
Well, Buke's got a camera bag, and I have a plastic Ziploc bag so that we could maybe put some in there so they wouldn't leak on the camera.
You know how you fucking... smuggle a can of GWAR beer
up your butt?
No, you act like you fucking done it before, Jay.
Yeah, you act like it's the most natural thing in the world. Be like,
who are you calling Jay?
He did it again. That's two before 8 a.m.
One was at 7:22 and one was at 7:49.
The thing is, I never do this with anybody in life at all, but I am so used to our three-piece with Jay.
Our triumvirate, yeah, of three-way metal podcast, yeah, anal.
So then when Will joins us, Will's a much more attractive man than Jay.
Well, that's an unfair thing to say when Jay has not actually been in our presence yet.
Well, fuck, okay. Well, Skype's not doing him any justice.
Well, that's because we only see him above the waist. He could have the cutest little ass that we don't even know about.
Okay. But seeing... you know, tight six-pack Will back here, okay?
Whoa,
an American soldier, okay?
Marine.
A Marine does, yeah, definitely take the sexy factor way up.
Okay, so I don't know how I get them confused. I never do this with anybody, but I'm just so used, again, to us talking with the dynamic of the podcast. I'm just saying that, okay?
Yeah, it's not like I go home and I'm like, hey... Jay, I mean Barb.
Yes.
Yeah, it doesn't happen to anybody, but or John even. We don't go, hey, Jay, I mean John. No, it's just you. I don't know what it is.
I don't know. I'm dying a little on the inside.
Well, I just want to point out, I have not done it yet. So it's 2-0, Buke.
I will say, if I'm going to get confused with somebody, be confused with Jay is not the worst thing in the world. It's not like... you know,
being confused with me,
yeah, or Jeffrey Dahmer or something like that. So,
okay, so something I'm curious about is this. Should George and I be pretty really honored that we got you to come with us? Is this something that you do, like going to concerts with your buddies? Because I know you go to shows, but you know, to go out of state for a show like this, should George and I feel pretty honored?
I know, I was really surprised. Yeah. I was like, there's no way he's going to do it. He's not going to do it. But then he did, and I just, like, got a little half-mast.
I will say two things. I don't have to go out of state because I live in Virginia.
Oh. Sure.
But it is still a good 2 hours away. No, I mean, obviously, if I could, in a zero-sum perfect world, I would go to a million shows, and I don't go to a lot of shows. I am married. I have two kids. I have responsibilities. I am a little surprised that my wife did not absolutely kill me when I said I wanted to go. But I kind of phrased it the way it really was, phrased to me by you two, is that if you don't go, we're going to kidnap your ass anyway. So, And anyway, and because we're doing the recording, she was pretty cool with it. So, you shouldn't be honored, so to speak, because I am honored that you're including me in on the podcast yet again. And I know what you're going to say, Buke, but I'm still honored.
I want to get something on the record when you're done. Can I please, we mentioned it when we did a recording the other day, but can I please say again, we have, you know, brought you on board as a, which you are, a member of this podcast.
Our remote correspondent.
Yeah, he is. He is a part of this. This is not a three-piece. This is actually a four-piece.
I'd go so far as to call John the fifth wheel.
Yeah. Hi, this is John.
Hi, this is John.
But I just wanted to say, Will, your fucking effort this week on the social media attack, man, it's been awesome.
Yeah, I do wonder about some of the bands that followed us back. I'm like, what the fuck is this band? But hey, reach is reach, man.
Yes.
And
yes,
you can reach around me anytime.
His social media, you know, footprint, you know, for a 48-year-old is pretty good.
48.
I'm just
Buke doesn't understand age. He keeps thinking I'm that old too.
But I will say, as of right now, we have 300 followers on Twitter. So that we start, when I took over, we were at 167. So in a week, we got
almost double.
Yeah, we got 133 or whatever that math
and
is.
No porn bots.
I don't know. There might have been one or two that we just picked up on their own, because I saw a couple sketchy ones that may not have had anything to do with you.
Yeah. I think there are a few porn bots out there.
We all pick up some along the way, you know.
You probably more than others.
You know, Buke's usually the one that wants to hunt down the porn stars, but I was thinking the other day, I was like, you know, probably should just go out and, like, follow, like, every conceivable porn star, because I know a bunch of them like metal, and maybe we can get some reach there, too. Or reach around there, whatever.
It's all about the reach.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny, you know, we're sitting here going, oh, we're honored to have Will, and Will's like, I'm honored to have you be on here, and it's sort of like two Japanese businessmen bowing to each other, and like, no, you, and you know, and it's like this guy I used to work with used to say, there's no winning a polite war. We're going to take a traffic picture. There you go.
That's going up.
On the road to GWARBQ. Traveling at a nice, you know, relaxed 11 miles per hour.
Yep.
In the fast lane. Life in the fast lane, kids. This is it. Next to all the people on their way to the beach.
As we're occupying some time here, we were going to do a impromptu little recording last night with Jay.
But Jay fucked it up,
because the world was introduced to the first taste of the new Iron Maiden single and video for Speed of Light.
And I really think we should probably we'll leave it at that. We're
from,
not gonna
from us. I want to get Will's take.
Fair enough. Will, your take on the new Iron Maiden single Speed of Light.
I think it is a very, very, very good rock and roll song performed by Kiss. I have to say I'm disappointed in it. It just literally, it sounds like Kiss. I listened to it on repeat today when I was getting ready, getting a shower. And, you know, the cowbell in the beginning, and it just sounds like a Kiss song. It does not sound like Iron Maiden. And part of me, I was thinking, all right, you know, you got to give Bruce a little bit of a pass because of the whole cancer thing, and I was like, okay, you know, don't be so critical. Not every song can be the best song, but I'm sitting there thinking that if this is the single that they're releasing, which a lot of times they try it, you know, they want it to be the best song, then I have to say I'm disappointed.
Fair enough. To hear the opinion of myself and Mr. Buke, and of course Jay, you'll have to tune into the episode 33 when we get around to recording that, probably tomorrow. So I'm not sure which is going to hit the airwaves first, whether it'll be the GWARBQ episode or episode 33, but you can find our opinions on that there.
And I just want to say for the record, I'm an enormous Iron Maiden fan, which we all are. And so it's not like I am just sort of some way for, sometimes I like Iron Maiden, sometimes I don't. Like, I fucking love Iron Maiden. And so it kills me to say those words. It really does.
Despite that, I'm sure you would much rather listen to that than anything from, say, Justin Bieber's catalog.
Well, you know, he does have some really good tunes, you know.
All right. Okay.
It's the Prius talking.
The influence of the Prius is overcoming us. I feel a great urge to vote for Hillary Clinton. But, yeah. All right. Well, do we have anything else that we want to talk about before we arrive at GWARBQ 3 days from now?
Nope.
I'm good for now.
All right, we'll talk to you later.
Bye.
Hello again. We are now inside the GWARBQ, and we've seen a couple bands so far. We saw Troglodyte, and who's that, Critter that's playing right?
Gritter.
Gritter? With a G? Okay.
G.
And they're playing now, and they're pretty badass. You might be able to hear them in the background.
Yeah, there's a lot of some bands I never heard of before, and some of them are really fucking good.
Yeah. So, Will, what do you think of the atmosphere so far, brother?
This is awesome. I'm just so mad because when I tried to come down a couple years ago and it was canceled here and went indoors, definitely not the same vibe. This is a good vibe. Lots of merch booths.
There's a fucking skate park set up right here.
Skate park. This guy's riding their BMX bikes into the lake. There's rope swings. There's tons of great food options, like tons of food trucks. So it's not like your typical frozen meat patty. They throw some processed cheese on it. Like, there's actually really good food. The beer, so I got to say, being the brewer I am, so I'm drinking the odorous ale, and it's good. It's a really, really, really hoppy pale ale.
And it's a tall boy this year.
Yeah, it's a 16-ounce tall boy, so it's pretty badass. And I saw the guys from the Cigar City wearing their shirts, and it had to be the cellarman, the production operations, like the head brewer, basically, Josh, and one of the owners. And just chatted to them for a while and, like, talked to them a little bit how the whole concept for the Gwar beer came up. And they're total metalheads. It's fucking badass. Like, I always love Cigar City beer. I have a whole new respect for that brewery now, just because they're metalheads.
How about fucking beer and metal go together like chocolate and peanut butter?
Kind of like me and you and Buke.
Oh, yeah. A metal sandwich.
Thank you so much.
So, we also had the opportunity to talk with Tony from Municipal Waste and Iron Reagan. He's not playing this year, but of course he's from the Richmond area, so he's down here, supporting his friends and just hanging out. So that was pretty cool. Last year we chased him all over the park because we saw him, and we never did get a chance to talk to him. So it was nice to talk to him, and I'm sure whether it's part of this or as a separate interview podcast with all our interviews, you'll be hearing from him. So... it is hot as fuck out here right now.
It's not that hot. Let's caveat all this. George is the only of the three of us. He's the one wearing a black shirt.
And
when
I
you're wearing a white shirt, it's not that bad.
And I weigh like 5,000 pounds, so I am the fat man sweating.
You can't be over 350. Come on.
No, I'm not.
but we saw Buke and I briefly talked to the guy from Troglodyte, and his name is escaping me. Yeah, dude, holy shit, that is a good band. Like,
yeah, they were awesome.
Jeffrey.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, dude, check out Troglodyte. It's almost like a Bigfoot-inspired, not almost, it's a Bigfoot-inspired band. They were one of the first bands to come on. We only saw them, like, the last three songs because, again, the snafu is the band started at, like, 10:15 and opened the doors at 10 o'clock, so it took us a while to get in. But anyway, awesome, phenomenal. Like, I'm an instant huge fan of Troglodyte.
Hell yeah.
That like, is like brutal. It's like brutal death metal, but really good.
Yeah. And there's like three stages this year. Last year there were only two. So there's two big stages, the Scum Dog stage and the Slaughterama stage. Those are the big ones. And then there's a Slutman stage in the middle that's like the smaller stage. And you'll have two of the stages playing at one time. So it's like, ah, what do? You got to run around. And so it's going to keep us on our toes trying to catch people. But
yeah, I have to say, it is almost annoying that they almost have too many stages. I should say annoying. I shouldn't complain. It's almost, but there's three stages and you have to pick and choose which one you want to see. I almost, in a weird sort of way, almost wish it was one stage. So when they're changing over, you had time to go check out merch and then check out the band.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of like Bakken. There's just, Bakken has so many stages, you can't possibly hit all of them. You just have to pick and choose.
Wait, have you been to Bakken?
No, but
that's what you heard. Okay.
But based on talking to Corey in Nine Circles, he said that, yeah, there's no way. Because there's like nine stages or something like that. And so you really just got to pick the bands you want to see and go see them.
Yeah, totally.
Anything to add, Buke?
No, I'm just to echo what Will said, already fucking thought Troglodyte was amazing so far. They've been very nice to talk to on top of that. Look forward to interviewing them. It was cool running into Tony. Just, now we've already had a beer, so just having a blast so far.
Alrighty. Well, we'll carry on and we'll check back in with you later.
Hello, it's George again. I'm about to slide in a couple of the interviews we did. Here's the first one. We just happened to see Tony Foresta of Municipal Waste and Iron Reagan as he was hanging out, and we managed to snag him for a few minutes for an interview. Here it is.
Okay, this is Buke.
And George.
And George. And we have finally, after attempting all last year to stop him, we finally are out with Tony of Municipal Waste and Iron Reagan. What's up, brother?
Hello, how you doing?
Doing well. In case, again, I didn't tell you over there, when this is the Metalheads podcast. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks now, for having me.
For those who don't know, last year, Iron Reagan played underneath this little...
I like that you're pointing and it's a podcast. They can't hear you pointing.
Exactly. So air quotes, this fucking structure over here with the roof. You guys played underneath that last year.
Yeah.
And fucking people were hanging from the rafters for you guys for your set. This year, you get here, and there's fucking plastic and tarp, and you ruined the fun.
It was not my fault.
Well.
I didn't tell them to do that. Yeah. I didn't tell them to get in the rafters.
Exactly.
And I appreciate them getting in the rafters.
Because it made for a fucking badass clip.
It's awesome that you're not actually playing this year, but because you're from the Richmond area, you're out here checking it all out. That's great.
It's all my friends. A lot of my friends are involved in this at multiple levels, from setting up the stage to playing in bands. You know, you got to come support the scene, man. Yep. Metal in general, you know, like there's not a lot of good festivals going on in America for metal, so you gotta fucking support that shit.
You mean to tell me you didn't buy a ticket for the wonderful Mayhem Fest that was going around?
I went.
What do you think about that as an artist and drama and all the shit that's come out recently?
That's a good question. I think they just had a poor decision in the bands they chose. When they say metal's dying, no, metalcore's dying. Nobody fucking listens to that shit. Get some real bands, dude.
Yep, that's what we were saying.
I'm not saying, like, I don't know. There was some really killer bands on there, like Code Orange, Jungle Rot, Slayer, King Diamond, of course, you know, and like, I'm a fan of all kinds of music, but I just think that they could have chose a better lineup, and because you didn't choose a good lineup, don't blame it on metal being old and fat and bald. Be like, I didn't book the right bands.
Yep.
It's not that big a deal. Say you fucked up.
Well, this is a great festival, and I hope it continues for many years. Who are a few of the ones that you're really looking forward to seeing today?
Descendants are my favorite band. Descendants and Slayer are my tied for my favorite bands.
Descendants is the one I wanted to see the most today.
They're my favorite. I love them. I like nerd. I don't nerd out on people.
But them.
I really nerd out. Yeah. I love Descendants.
Yeah.
Ghoul is going to... My prediction is Ghoul is going to steal this show. They're going to fucking own this place. And Of course, Goatwhore. I mean, I could name off honestly half the bands on this bill, but my prediction is that Ghoul is going to fucking own this place.
I came in here, they're one of the bands I'm most excited to see. I hope that Goatwhore will be able to actually make it this year.
Put Ghoul on fucking Mayhem Fest.
Yeah.
For real.
Yeah. So, before we let you go here, plans for you guys. What's on the... Because I know you were a fucking road dog for a while.
We're writing songs now, man. Like, we had the past 2 years has been nonstop touring with Iron Reagan. We did a Municipal Waste show this past weekend. It was great. And we're just... Now we got to write some fucking songs. That's, like, you know... The Iron Reagan album's been out for almost a year.
Fucking great album.
The Waste album has been out for almost 4 years, which is crazy. Maybe 3 years. But that's crazy to me, like... Miss Waste has been such a big part of my life, and this is the longest we've ever been without writing music. But we're on the case. We're locking horns. We're starting to make it work again. It's great. It's exciting.
Do you ever stop and take a step back, and when people say that, you know, that thrash sound that you guys and Toxic Holocaust and them brought back, do you take a step back and realize that, and maybe are kind of realize that you were the catalyst for a lot of these bands and this genre kind of coming back?
You know, I hope so. I mean, I'm not looking for credit or anything. I just hope people realize what we did. You know, all those years of fucking touring, like fucking 13 years now.
You know, the one thing about you that always has struck me and George, we were saying this earlier, you on stage, you always look like you're having fun. You guys,
I wouldn't do it if I didn't love it.
Yeah,
it's why we're all here, man. Yeah. That's why you're here right now.
Yeah, truly.
That's why you guys are doing this podcast. Yeah. Well, if you're doing it because it's a fucking job, fuck that.
Yeah, fuck that. Well, again, it's an honor to talk to you. You're so great.
Thank you
very
much.
Day, brother.
Thank you so much. Cheers.
All right, that was awesome. Thanks for speaking with us, Tony. Next up, after chatting with them at their merch booth, we dragged Jeff and Chris from Troglodyte off into the forest for an interview. Here's what they had to say.
Hey, this is Buke from the Metalheads podcast, and I'm Will and George are here. And we are joined with Jeff and Chris from Troglodyte. Gentlemen, Jeff and I were just saying it is fucking hot out here.
It's warm.
It's warm.
So beautiful, warm, Richmond summer day.
Yeah. Yeah. So for everybody else who might not know, listening to this podcast, who Troglodyte is, first off, stop right there. Go on Bandcamp right now. Fucking type in their name. Listen to them and fucking buy their shit. If you like death metal, if you like just pure classic, your fucking sound, you're fucking set.
And if you like Bigfoot.
Yes. Oh, yeah. More importantly.
Yes. Yeah, so you got to get that
part. Explain the whole Bigfoot thing. I'm fascinated. I love it.
It's a little complicated. I'll just bear with me on this. So Chris and I, about 10 years ago, decided that maybe we should write songs about Bigfoot.
Complicated. It's overly complicated.
This is before all the fucking...
That's long story short.
I'm trying to undercomplicate things here.
We keep things fucking... as low as possible here.
Yeah, no, there's Chris and I had a mutual friend who introduced us. Chris was playing drums, and I don't know what the impetus for the whole thing was, but we just decided, you know, we were farting around making music, and, you know, I was like, we should write, I think in my mind somewhere I'd already had an idea that, like, to really have a really niche band like that is almost like, it's like Nile, except even worse. Not that Nile's bad, but like, it seems like in theory, like when you look, I remember telling it to Chris, it's like, in theory, I thought it looked better on paper, because I remember telling him and the look on his face, and he's like, what? Bigfoot? All of them? And then, you know, you add the layer of, and then we're going to wear these goofy looking rubber masks, and we'll all wear the same, miserably warm clothing, and
you guys are definitely in a heavy cotton, like, black work shirt
It's a Dickies. It's a Workman's Choice. They breathe. You know, surprisingly enough, we've switched shirts out before.
So this one's the second model.
Well, we've tried different kinds of shirts, and we go back to, we had some other kind of, the reason we use these kind of work shirty kind of stuff is because they actually do take a little bit of abuse, and I had these OneWorks shirts, and man, it's like they were they really didn't breathe. So I don't know. I kind of feel like I'm pimping Dickies, and I shouldn't. But
no, you should, because as a brewer, our work shirts are Dickies.
Yeah, I mean, we need that sponsorship. That would be great. But they're good shirts. I mean, it takes us a long time to tear one up. But yeah, I mean, you know, when you get to a point where you're just uncomfortable, and it is what it is. So, like I said, in theory, it may have sounded like a good idea, and maybe it looks cool. I don't know, but.
Definitely looks cool.
Yes.
Well, thanks. I guess we don't look like because I would. I was really hoping we didn't look like complete idiots, like we, just partial tomfoolery.
I love the fucking honesty from these guys.
Kind of like Niall mated with Slipknot in a way.
Not musically.
Yeah. Only because of the masks.
No. I always love that. It's like,
don't pay attention to this man.
No. Hey, listen, Slipknot. Slipknot's, listen, man, people, you like their music or not, those guys got it going on, man. They're I'll take one of their paychecks, you know. Yeah. That's
So on the back of your shirt it says 352 Field Research Team. Can you explain that?
Yeah, that's pretty nerdy, Bigfoot nerdy. If you're familiar, there's a really famous, probably the quintessential film of Bigfoot. It's called the Patterson.
Where he stops and turns around?
Yeah, he's running across the dry creek bed, the creature is. And there's a moment in that film, and it's frame 352, where the creature is looking right back at the camera. So there's your Bigfoot nerd reference. We have a song called 352. It's it just seemed like, you know, I don't know. It just seemed like something to throw on the back of the shirt. It generates some conversation. You know, people ask about 352.
I'm definitely wondering what it means.
Yeah, no, it's literally, it's the 352nd frame of the Patterson-Gimlin film. Google that. Shouldn't be too hard. Yeah, no, that's some serious Bigfoot nerdery going on there.
So are you guys fans of, I don't know if it's on TLC or Discovery or History, the Finding Bigfoot TV reality show?
Where they go, as they call it, squatching?
Squatching, yeah.
It's entertainment.
Yeah, it's pretty good. Bobo, right?
Yeah, Bobo.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny. It's
crystals
like,
kinda look like
they're
little,
throwing rocks at me.
Yeah. you know, I'm... It is what it is.
Yeah, it is.
You know, it's funny, though. There's a really good buddy of ours, Jared. He used to sing for a band of orcs.
Okay.
And they all dressed up. Yeah, they all dressed up.
They made our fucking
list
a couple years ago.
Yeah. So, they were in his town, city, where he lives. They were filming some stuff, so he went. And he took our CDs and was showing them. He's got these great pictures of the cast looking at this, like, with this really puzzled look, like, really? Like, you know.
And, wait. This is the guys from the reality show putting on this reality show. I'm doing air quotes.
I think
looking at your CD going, really?
But like in Bigfootery, I guess. It's like, this is the ultimate, like... Are you kidding me? All of them are big. You can almost like see the conversation going back and forth between like the girl and one of the other guys that was talking to Jared. You could almost like just look at the pictures and go, really? All of them are big? And they're looking at the song titles and oh, okay. All right. Yeah.
I guess that works. So I have to ask, do you guys like the movie Harry and the Hendersons?
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's a great film.
You got the 1991 Harry and the Hendersons doll in the practice space.
Yeah. That's a great movie. I mean, it's not all like blood, guts, and gore in our world. I mean, we put that spin on it. We've got there's a song on our first album called Hit by the Hendersons.
Nice.
I mean, you know.
Fucking great. I fucking love you guys.
Yeah, I mean, it's ridiculous.
Like I said, we played your... One of your songs on Spotify.
You explained it to
us. Was it the one about Bigfoot?
Driving down here. Maybe.
They're all about Bigfoot. Okay.
Driving down here, like we told you earlier, we played a quick 30-second clip for you guys. And Will's like, that's it. I'm finding these guys. I'm watching them and I'm buying them.
After listening to it for 5 seconds, yep. I was like, perfect. I'm done.
Yep. That's good. Well, thanks, man.
I have to ask
Usually it takes it a good... four or five listens to even be palatable to most people, I think.
Before you can actually use a CD as like a, you know, a cup holder.
They're terrible coasters.
Well, after I download it into my computer, then I'll use it as a as a beer coaster.
Now, guys, getting away from the whole talking about crazy Bigfoot shit, like, let me talk about your guys' band here.
What else?
How long have you guys?
There's something else besides crazy Bigfoot shit? What? Huh?
How long have you guys been actually around and?
About 10 years. About 10 years.
Wait.
First show was in 2006, but first demos.
It all started in the basement. We figured if the music stunk, really wasn't much point in getting dressed up like idiots because there's already enough people doing that. So, we worked pretty hard on the music before. I mean, it was funny. We're from Kansas City, and it was funny when we first started. It was really tough for us to get a show. Like, nobody, I don't know if they just... it's like, I don't think it was intentional per se, but it's just like nobody really wanted to play with us. And it was really strange. You know, there were a couple of bands who they kind of got what we were doing, I think. And then once we started playing and people saw it and they realized how ridiculous this is, it's like, and then they can kind of get behind it a little bit and see what's going on. We don't take ourselves too terribly seriously, obviously, but we take the music side of things seriously.
That's why I wanted to interject here, because literally not knowing anything, like, never saw you guys on stage. And of course, you guys wear the mask and, you got your shirts on and everything. But literally, I was captivated by the first 5 seconds of the music, like, aside from the other stuff. So that's excellent. Why when you
thank
say
you.
This,
thank
like,
you.
I find it hard to believe that if people heard you, like, why would they?
Well, you got to think too, this is 10 years ago, where we were 10 years ago, and MySpace, bands really, I don't think bands were quite as aggressive with social media stuff as they are now. Again, it's a little...
The band camps weren't there.
Yeah, it's a little different animal, you know? And again, I think people, it's funny, we played with bands and then... for whatever reason, another show opportunity would come up and we'd play with it. It's like, oh shit, I thought that was just a goof. You guys are a real band. Like, I remember hearing that a couple times and it was like, but I get it. It's not for everybody, It's like, I love, it's like, what are you guys supposed to be, Slipknot or something? It's like, I get that. It's obvious. You wear a mask. We're not the first band to wear a mask. We're not the last band to wear a mask.
The music is nothing like the music.
No,
Slipknot.
If anything, I always thought that it was closer to something like some really extreme bands like Berserker. I don't know if you ever heard those guys. Mm-hmm. Very, very extreme earache band. More akin to stuff like that, really. So that was because obviously, that's the one thing. It's like you'll see bands like we were talking about. Is it Lorde? Lorde?
Yeah.
Lorde? Lorde?
Yeah, the ones who
Lorde.
Eurofest a couple years back.
It's like I see those guys and I want to like them. They look so brutal, and then you hear them and it sounds kind of like it's very light, light.
Yeah.
And it's like
very accessible.
Yes, and which is crazy because their look is so inaccessible. And I really wish that they were more, they matched the look. And that was the thing. It's like we were trying to come up with something that was like, okay, we have this look, we have this music, this all works, it's all one big thing, and hopefully it all comes together, so.
Yeah, it's kind of funny, though, because they're these monster guys with, like, a sensitive side, it's like they're, do you love them, could you love a monster, man, it's kind of funny, but.
It's not all blood and guts in our world. I mean, it's, again, tongue firmly in cheek when and you can go on Bandcamp and look at the lyrics, there's a little bit of thought. Very little, but there is a little bit of thought, that's put into some of these songs. I mean, some of them read like a textbook. I mean, they're ridiculous, talking about, there's a song called Cripple Footcast, which is, I'm literally talking about the examination of plaster casts and comparing dermal ridges to animals. And it's like, but you read it, it works.
I've been in the band for 10 years. I'm just learning this now. I don't
know. Yeah. They don't use... There's not...
He's just sitting there hitting the hi-hat like,
it's,
what?
Really? What the fuck did he just say?
It's really funny because the last couple of records we recorded, we did it a little differently than we... Like the first one, it was more... We had all these songs that we've been playing for quite a while. So, but this last time we went in the studio, it was... Chris and Michael and our bass player Brandon They were working on the songs kind of without my involvement, just kind of, and then they would play it for me. It's like, what do you think? It's like, well, it's okay. It's like, well, that's all you're getting, so that's you're gonna have to, it's gonna have to work.
Guys are great.
Can't be no better than that. So but then I take the songs, yeah. And then I tried to be there, and because everybody's got, you know, I got a little guy, I got a wife, everybody's got their shit going on, so you're not always there. So it's kind of like, you know, it's interesting. Sometimes you get, there's a couple of those songs, you know, we really worked on. It's like, let's move this. Now let's shorten this up. Or then there's some of the songs that they just gave me and I didn't have any input and they're amazing. And then it's like, how the heck am I supposed to write something to this? That's always a good chance. When they give me a song and it's like, holy crap, what am I supposed to do with this? I have no idea. It's like, you know, and it's like, I don't even think I can even breathe. Like, if I try to, so it's always engaging and, yeah. You know, trying to come up. It's like, well, how many songs can you write about Bigfoot? Well, let me tell you something, brother. You can write a whole lot of songs about Bigfoot. So it's not just about Bigfoot. It's like I said, it's any facet, you know. Boy, there's the guy with the Speedo. I was wondering when he was going to show up.
Yeah, he was here last year. Yep. I don't think he watched.
I really hope he put on sunscreen.
He's looking a little pink already.
So, Don't Go in the Woods came out in 2012, if I recall. Yeah. Is there any new music on the horizon?
Yeah. We're wrapping up recording now on the new record. We've got like two more songs I've got to finish vocals on and probably do a pass, and then we'll get it mastered, and it should be out. I want to try to get it out by the fall, you know, like October.
This year.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, are you kidding? We got bills to pay.
I already predict this is going to be on someone. So we, at the end of the year, we do a wrap-up podcast, and we do the top 25 or whatever it is, and there's four or five of us who do it, and I guarantee...
Oh, I'm right.
This is going to make someone's list.
And will there be any vinyl?
Yeah.
Because your guys' album artwork is awesome.
Well, I can't take credit for that. That's a whole other can of worms right there. The guy...
Chris is I'm done. I'm walking away.
No, the art is great.
I love watching Chris throughout this interview.
let me get... people have always given me well, you know, it's like the art's great. It is great. The problem was that the artist who created it...
is dead?
He used other pieces of art. Oh. He did some digital hodgepodge, and he...
So maybe in the future, then, Bigfoot will have to morph into...
Well, no, maybe in the future...
some other
in the future, we won't give him our fucking money, is what we'll do.
Okay.
So,
because you don't want to end up going to court and getting sued. And...
yeah, he didn't see... yeah, anyway.
Pretty bad for a minute, though.
It wasn't just us. It was a lot of bands this kind of... so I don't want to... it's water under the bridge.
Yeah, water under the fucking bridge.
I already flushed that toilet. Yeah. So the new cover, I did the art myself. I think it's really good. It's in the vein of those. And I think, you know, again, it's, you know, we're not Cannibal Corpse. I'm not going to outgross somebody with it. But I want something that looks really slick. I want it. Yeah, I would say it's probably the most ridiculous album title. I mean, I can't even really remember it right off the top of my head. It's like 20 words, and it's just stupid. I'm not really sure. It's a good idea. I really wish I could remember that now. It is ridiculous. We don't want to, you know, we'll have a big unveiling. Yeah, that's what it is. I can't tell you now. It's going to be all hush hush. Yeah, it's all hush hush. Not the fact that I can't remember what I had for breakfast this morning, but we'll drop that. We'll once we get a little closer, we want to put stuff out on vinyl. The vinyl thing is so messed up right now. It's like it'll have to come later, or we're just going to have to do a thing where once everything's done and we put it into production, how many months it's going to take to get the vinyl back. That's the bad thing. It's good and bad. I mean, it's good that vinyl's kind of had this resurgence, but it's bad because they don't have the facilities to keep up with the demand right now. Yeah. So little guys like us, you know, we go, oh, we'd like, you know, we want to get some of our vinyl made. And it's like, okay, well, come back to us in about 8 months and we should maybe have time to start the production. And so, but we definitely want to do that. I mean, that was my only gauge of success. It's like, man, if I can get something on a record, I know I've really done something. So,
you definitely don't give yourself enough credit. Like, literally.
Oh, thank you.
Does.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I've been trying hard. So, I've been trying hard to not give myself credit for years. It's a it's a total team effort, and it's, like I said, man, it's a, I think it's a perfect storm of all these things that come together and made something kind of unique a little bit, that it's, it sounds refreshingly rip-off-ish, so.
But you know what, though? In this genre, with metal being around for a couple decades now, you're not going to be fucking breaking ground.
No, no. We're not reinventing the wheel. We're certainly not even trying to drive the car. Exactly. So that made no sense at all.
You know what, though? Fucking make it your own. Own it.
So as the Bigfoot ideas start to dry up, could we maybe see a crossover like Bigfoot versus the Loch Ness Monster or something?
There's actually a Loch band called, I think there's a band called... Now, Yeti, we do tap on. That's okay. That's kind of a cousin. That's the Asian cousin. As you all know, that is the Asian cousin of the North American Sasquatch. Anyway, there's a band. I think they're called Loch Ness.
Okay.
I played a festival, or I saw them at a festival.
Jeff or Chris, you guys ever get approached by these? Again, we go back to those TV shows. Everybody, there are those weird conspiracy theorists out there. Matt from High on Fire right now seems to be one of those wackos. But do you guys have anybody coming up to you fucking, I saw him.
Oh, yeah.
I've seen proof.
No,
look at this.
You know what? That's the great thing about this. Even if, and,
I'm asking, do you guys believe going along with that?
Here's what I'm
going
to tell you. Here's my stock answer.
Great answer.
Blacked out for a second. Sorry, what happened? No, you know what I tell people? It's like, I think the reason Bigfoot's so enduring is it's this thing that it's not necessarily the creature himself, but the idea behind it, that there is something that we don't know. Is it there? It can, you know, people spent their whole lives chasing this thing around, trying to snap pictures of it. So to me, the idea is, you know, somebody could come out tomorrow and say, well, we got one, we killed him, they drug him out of the woods, and it's like,
would fucking blow up.
Okay, then. Well, yeah, don't. Might have to switch gears, yeah. Then so talk about something else. No, I mean it is really weird.
New Jersey Devil or the Chupacabra.
Yeah. And you know we kind of goof on it. There's this whole, they call it this whole crypto metal, like where these guys, they sing about cryptozoology is, you know, the study of these like Loch Ness Monster, Bigfoot, right. All these things. But there's a couple other bands that are doing it. We pretty much have the market on Bigfoot right now. That guy's back again.
That guy is just fucking...
Listen, I know no one can see this. He's got a bikini on, like a bikini bottom. It's a man.
Look at that coming through the fucking gate, though.
He's got Volkswagen tattoo on his left arm.
He's
weird.
He's not quite built for it.
The thing is, he needs a large, and he's wearing a medium.
Yeah.
And
yeah, it's...
It's 5 pounds of sausage. Yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, it's like 10 pounds of sausage in the 5-pound casing.
Yes. I feel like the guy last year was much more buff. And he was wearing like a neon one.
Maybe he let himself go. I mean, sometimes in the off season that happens.
Okay, so
wait, hold on. Look what's coming through now.
That's what I said.
Speaking of bikinis.
That's what I look said. Like, speaking about something.
Holy shit.
Speaking about someone being a little too small.
God bless her. You know what she's doing? She's doing what she wants to do, and
there's
God bless
your big,
her.
There's Bigfoot,
yeah,
Jeff.
Yeah.
Wow.
What can I say?
There's your. I don't have that kind of guts.
God bless her.
Yeah.
God bless her, man.
Yep.
I don't want.
Yeah. Let's just
move on.
Hey, yeah, Chris, let me ask you guys. Let me get you in on this.
Okay.
For those who may hear you guys and go on Bandcamp and buy your guys' stuff, who's, you know, hooked on you guys now like we instantly are, you guys touring coming up, what's your guys' future plans when you're done with this record? Do you guys leave the Kansas City area?
Every now and then. We got the big Hammerween show. Shout out to Terry Taylor in Kansas City. It's a bunch of local bands. What is that, the 19th, I think, this year, or 20th? 19th.
Sure.
Yeah.
Stevie Cruz now. I can't remember the exact date.
Do a Google search. It's okay. Yeah.
But it's I mean, I'm sure we're going to go out of town on it a little bit. Yeah. We don't do a whole lot. You know, we do like little 2-week stints. You know, we've done a couple, you know, one 2-week stint, and then a lot of weekend warrior stuff. You know, but.
Was this your guys' first?
17th.
Yeah. Okay. The 17th. Was this your guys' first metal band that you guys really.
This is the only like band, like real band I would say that I've ever been in where we put out music. Chris is a veteran of.
Veteran.
Are you really?
I'm just veteran. Oh man, I'm so old right now.
You're old road dog.
I ran down and it's over. I missed my third band, I'd say. Maybe not in a particular order, but been in three.
Jesus.
Well.
He keeps himself busy. Keeps him out of trouble.
George, you got anything, Will?
I'm good. This has been a pleasure.
Gentlemen, it's truly a pleasure to speak to you guys.
It's our pleasure.
Honestly, I know a lot of this stuff you think, let's talk to these bands just because you kind of have to. No, we wanted to talk to you guys.
I would never think that. Yeah. Who on their right mind would want to talk to, like, I mean, really chase after us? You've got to have some serious,
Yeah, we only talk to the ones we like.
No, I was going to say, you've got some serious mental problems if you're wanting to talk to us.
Yeah.
Well,
can't deny that.
Yeah. We can't deny that. Yep. No. Just truly.
Oh, no. It was a pleasure.
Jeff and Chris, thank you very much, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Moving on, our next interview is with Ben from Goatwhore. As you will be able to tell from our discussion on it, this interview made a lasting impression on all of us. It was good fun. Thanks, Ben.
Are we recording?
Yep.
Okay. Hey, everyone. This is Metalheads Podcast. I'm George. I'm here with Buke and Jay, and we're talking to Ben from Goatwhore.
Yeah!
Oh, fuck it. Sorry, I fucked it up.
Our friend's name.
Sorry, let me start.
All
you gotta do is fix it. No, just fix it.
Sorry, I meant Will.
Yeah, so we have been trying to fucking track you down all day.
I've been right here. I had to be here from fucking 12:30 to 1:30.
This is our fucking time now, so it's on us. Okay. You did everything right.
I was here. Yeah. Right here.
We were going all over the fucking...
I don't need to blame because then they'll start blaming me for shit. I don't need to act on shit.
We were doing everything wrong. So, Goatwhore.
Yeah.
How is everything in the world of Goatwhore now?
It's going good, man. It's going pretty good. Keeping busy. You know, we just got off a full-fledged like headlining tour with fucking Black Breath, Ringworm, and Theories. It was really fucking cool. And then we just, you know, we have this GWARBQ thing we're doing today, and then we have a couple of weeks around it playing some more odd markets, like, you know, like Huntington, West Virginia, Toledo, Ohio. You know, it's odd. Yeah, you know, for real though, the U.S. is big, and there's a lot of cities a lot of bands don't hit. And the thing we like to do is, when we tour, yeah, you hit all the major markets. You go back and you hit all these little, like, smaller markets so that people don't have to fucking drive to a bigger city to go see you. You know what I'm saying?
Well, we're having that problem right now because I live in the D.C. area and in Northern Virginia, and the one place, Jack/Empire Nova, that closed down, that was the place. In fact, I saw Soylent Green there.
Yeah.
And that closed down. So now like, you got to drive to Baltimore because all the shows go to Baltimore.
Easy. The only thing that sucks is y'all's traffic sucks.
Yeah. Fucking is horrible.
You know terrible. What? Y'all have too many people, dude. Yeah. No. Don't take this in offense, but you need some kind of...
Offend me.
Offend us.
They need
I'm
some
not con- from this area.
You're from,
I'm from
Philly. Philly. Offending people is what you guys... You don't hold back.
Maybe there's need to be a war up in the Northeast to kind of slim down the population. You know what I'm saying?
We need the plague.
You have too many people in vehicles everywhere, dude. You know, it's like, dude, okay, if I'm home and I get caught in a little traffic and I feel like I'm getting annoyed, I'm like, remember when you were like around New Jersey and you got caught driving? I'm like, yeah, this isn't shit. Like talking to myself going, this isn't shit. Those people are fucked because they hang out in their car majority of the day.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
So it's like,
talk to this guy. He's got a Prius. Yeah. You know why he's got a Prius? He drives like 100 miles a day to get
I have a van. The van that we tour in. That's what I drive around. It's a V8 6.0 liter.
So you get what, like 5 miles a gallon?
It sucks up gas like crazy. It drinks it like fucking...
like we're drinking beer.
Yes.
We just fucking pound it.
There's oil refineries down in NOLA. So it's gas cheaper down there?
What? It's, I think, when I left home, the cheapest I saw was $2.16 a gallon.
Whoa!
Yeah!
Dude, that's cheap!
Yeah!
Dude, you can move down there, commute up. You save some money.
I got the Prius. It would be fucking work.
Dude, why don't you get
it?
One of those, like, what's that? The VW TDI or whatever. Yeah, it's like a diesel. You get like 40 miles to the gallon.
I got one better for you. My hybrid Prius, 52.
Holy shit.
But really, I'm at a fucking GWARBQ in the Prius. And earlier this year, we went to Maryland Death Fest in the Prius.
Know why? You park really far away and you take a bus. You don't
Nobody sees me in it.
Or you park far away and you get your friend in the fucking big Silverado with the big wheels sucking up gas to bring you in. And people are like, that shit's cool as fuck.
When I pull up in my Prius, they think, oh, the guy's going to be fucking protesting our hair.
What's funny is that in the South, as poor as the South, because the South's poor, you know. There's a lot of tours that miss a lot of cities. I mean, even in New Orleans, we don't get a lot of shows. Even when I was growing up, I drove to Houston to go see a lot of tours because they didn't come through. But we will buy a V8 engine, 6.0 liter, or 454 you know, $350 or $454, and suck up gas and spend money on that just to have that, but say, damn, I don't have no fucking money.
And you live in a trailer.
Yeah, I don't have any money, but goddamn, I will buy gas three times a week to put in this fucking thing. And people in the South do it. Because you go everywhere in the South and everybody's got big old trucks.
They got big old mother tires fucking getting 5 miles a gallon.
Oh, yeah, sucking it up. I got this truck. It has 11 miles a gallon. I raised it, put big old mud tires on it. Now it gets 4 miles to the gallon.
But it fucking looks cool doing
it. I thought about it too because I have a Silverado at home. And I was like, I want to raise it and put big tires on it. And some girl was telling me, that just means... You know, dudes that do that have little dicks. Yeah. I was like, no, when I was little, I used to like fucking vehicles that were jacked up, like, big like that. And, like, I don't like... Okay, let me tell you this. I'm more of a classic person. So, I like old muscle cars with stuck-up gas. Yes.
Yeah.
Like, Dodge Chargers, you know, 68, 67 to, like, 73. And then... Or Cudas, you know, whatever. But then I also like trucks, but... The thing is, what they did with trucks is they started to make the rims big, you know, because it was popular. So it's like, oh, 18-inch rims with these little tires and it's jacked up.
Yeah.
No, I want a 16-inch rim with a fucking huge tire going around.
You
want
to hit the fucking dog and just keep that. What was that?
For me is, I was like, I like it because when I was a kid, I liked it and I never got to have it. Well, I had those little stupid toys that were it, but I always wanted a truck.
Rocker stompers. Whatever,
I wanted a truck, but I wanted, because I went into a place and asked them, and they said, well, what do you want, like a frame lift or a suspension lift? I was like, oh, there's variations. And they're like, well, like if you're going to go actually, I said, well, you can get like a frame lift and it'll look bigger, but you don't really go off-road with it. I was like, no, I want to do all the cool shit with it, you know?
I'm so going down the bayou,
he's like,
bitch.
Oh, well, that's more expensive because you got to get all the stuff. And I was like, well, that's what I want. So tell me the price so I can say, no, I can't afford it.
Hey, we got to go on tour again. I got to pay for all these rims and tires.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, I couldn't wait to grow up so I could A, buy the General Lee, and B, buy the Smokey and the Bandit Trans Am.
Now I can. With the rebel flag on top of it.
And also, he really can't slide across the hood.
I keep trying, but I keep denting the fucking hood.
Totaling the engine.
You get in through the window, too, because the doors are welded shut, too.
He can't get through a convertible top.
Yeah.
He's this guy. This fucking every time he gets
you
in the car,
modified General Lee.
Yeah.
The doors
it'll have one of those slip and slides across the hood. Oh, water constantly pushing across, and the doors will open.
The windshield wipers the windshield wiper fluid's constantly going.
He is only getting in the car if you bring in the jaws of life and cut off the top half of the car. Yeah. Then he's fucking fitting in.
Yeah. We had those things where we wanted, you know, that was something we were like excited about when we were a kid, and that's what we wanted, you know, and I still have that. Even though, you know, I might not ever come to it because it is expensive, but it is something like, well, if I ever have a little money, I'd really like to do that. I'd really like to have, you know, the truck lifted up, whatever, go into the swamp and fucking get stuck, blow the transmission to pay more money.
You're telling me that as a kid growing up, you weren't like, wow, I really want a Prius.
They know such thing back then, of course.
Yeah, they didn't have that shit back then.
Yeah.
You know? We had back then too, we had fuel that didn't have ethanol in it too, you know? Yeah, I'm old.
So, coming from, I know you've probably been asked this 100 times. Coming from down south and the whole fucking NOLA scene, have you realized over the years how integral of a scene to the metal world?
How freaking awesome
it is. How fucking awesome it is.
I just, you know what, I noticed that, you know, after going around, you start to see, you know, it's funny because let's go back to like 89 90. I can't pinpoint it exactly, but crowbar
miles per gallon,
crowbar, okay, yeah. No, high miles, but
yeah, high miles.
Crowbar, I had gotten Soul and Green, did a tour in Europe, okay, and some shows are cool, good, and some shows were kind of so-so. But if you did that now, it would probably be really fucking, you know, people would be like, holy shit, you know? But it was like one of those things where like, where were you then? You know, where were you then with the thing? But it is, like, a lot of things happened back then. Even there was a tour in the States that was like that. It was Crowbar, I Got, Soul and Green. And we did a tour through the States like that, and it was kind of like, you know, some shows are okay, some shows are really good. But it's like, if you did it now, it'd be like, wow, you know, like a lot of people would be. And it's really cool to see the scene blow. And New Orleans scene isn't huge, you know what I'm saying? Like, the city isn't a huge city. Like, when you look at, like, New York, Chicago, L.A., Houston, things like that. Yeah, yeah. Like, New Orleans is comparable to, like, Richmond, you know, in size. Maybe a tad bit bigger. No, I never thought
of that. But, you know, you look back on some of the, what they call, like, the landmark albums along, you know, the years. Some of those albums are from the whole NOLA scene.
Yeah, no, no. Yeah, I
it's fucking crazy.
That, and you know, like, I listen to, like, I'll go back and listen to, like, I Got in the Name of Suffering, you know, and then, like, listen to it when it came out when I was younger, and then listen to it now, you're just like, holy shit, you know, I can't believe, like, this came out, and then how much of a movement it created.
Right.
And people fucking totally, you know.
Well, you were probably seeing Acid Bath on small fucking.
Oh, yeah, I mean, I played with Acid Bath so many times. Like, people would be like, I never saw Acid Bath, I never see it. And I was just going, I saw Acid Bath, like, 15 times.
Exactly. You're like, oh,
you know?
Oh, yeah. Acid Bath. Yeah.
But, you know, but I grew up in that scene. So I got to see a lot of things go on. You know, I got to see the evolution of what is Crowbar now from when, you know, when it was, like, Shell Shock. And then it evolved into Aftershock, into Requiem, into the Slugs, into Crowbar. You know what I'm saying? Like, things happen, members change, names change, things like that. You know, Pepper Keenan playing in Graveyard Rodeo, leaving the city, and then going playing with COC. And then, you know, eventually him, Phil, Kirk, and Jimmy and all get together and they do Down. You know, things like that. You know, it's just like, but the thing, that shows you even more close-knit how the scene is, because all these dudes are in, there's this many bands, but everybody's so close that there's, they're all in all these other bands.
Yeah. Yep.
You know? So it's like, it's not like that huge of a scene. And shows are fluctuant there. You'll have a show and there's 350 people there. And you'll have a show 2 months later and there's 75 people there. You know what I'm saying? So it's the South. It's just how it always is. And it was funny because I used to book shows too. Like, I used to promote shows and stuff, and I would just do door deals because I was like, I'm not taking on a guarantee because this scene is so, like, questionable on the turnouts that I'm not saying, oh yeah, I'm gonna take this show for $2,500 and then three people show up and I'm just like at the bank with the fucking thing and the guy from the tours being like, yeah, you gotta get all this money out. So I'm just like, I'll do a show, but it's a door deal. And sometimes a lot of people came out and it worked out really beneficial. You know, like I did a Dillinger Escape Plan show once and it did really fucking awesome. And then I did a Dillinger Escape Plan show and it didn't do so well. And the guys in Dillinger were great and they're like, why is it that every time that someone, like, is a good promoter, you have a bad show, and we take all this money from you, and then the people that, you know, we want to take the money from never have the fucking money, and they're fucking shitty people, you know? And it's true. It's like that. It's like, because, you know, I put myself on the line to make this happen, and I said I was going to pay this, so I have to pay it.
Right. Right, right. Yeah, I've heard lots of inside baseball, inside metal stories about this. Just sleazy promoters, just ripping bands off.
Yeah, I mean, it's a given. It's gonna happen.
Yep.
You know, it's just how the system is. You know, I mean, even in a huge system of, like, businesses in America, it's sleazy in aspects.
Oh,
so
yeah.
It's like, you know, it's just on a smaller scale with things like this. You know,
absolutely.
It's funny, like the metal, or let's say the underground extreme scene. It has no money, but everybody wants to make money from something in it, you know?
Right.
Like all these promoters and agents and stuff like that. And it's just like, how do you get blood from a stone? I don't fucking get it. You're going to try to make money. You're just like the government saying, all right, we need to save money, but here's how we're going to save it. We're going to spend more money.
Yes.
You know? It's just like, it's back. So what's going on? Where are y'all fucking working this out? Who's, you know, it's kind of funny because you're just like, even the fucking 5-year-old can figure out that this ain't gonna fucking work.
Yeah.
And how the hell y'all all adults sitting around and y'all think y'all have a magic plan?
Our government would figure it out by now. They clearly have not.
So the last couple months, you guys' last tour, you went on tour for a couple months, almost no fucking nights off. How do you handle that type of schedule?
I guess you just kind of get used to, you know how it is, and you know how to put yourself in a regimen to kind of do things on a daily basis with. It's like having a job, but you're like, all right, we're playing these shows. These are the drives. These drives are 8 hours. These drives are 3 hours. These drives are 10 hours. And you're like, I mean, some guys are just like, fuck it, I'm going to get fucked up. I don't care if we got to play at 2 p.m. the next day. And then they're miserable the next day. But
yeah,
it's just like, for me personally, I'm like, this is what I know needs to happen. This is how I need to do it. And as I get older, I'm like, when I'm at home, I need to work out. I need to keep myself stabilized because going out on the road is going to be tough. And I'm going to sleep on a bench seat and do all this fucking weird shit. And put my body through pure hell. So I need to kind of do something when I'm at home to keep things going as well. So there's an idea behind it. Sometimes it's not always followed, but you try to do as best as you can to make things work.
Yeah.
You know?
Ever since you guys burst onto the scene, your guys' albums critically have been pretty acclaimed. You know, they've gotten great reviews. They've been loved by everybody. Do you...
That's because they're awesome.
No, they are. They are pretty fucking amazing. Do you ever take a step back and even worry about that stuff, or do you...
I don't... You know what? I don't like to... I don't really read a lot of... Every now and then, like, some of the other guys read a lot of shit on the internet, and they're like, did you see this thing? And I'm just like, I'm not really... I think I got to a point at a certain age where I was just like, I'm not concerned with it. It's not... You know, it's like... I think sometimes you have to, like, even, like, when you look at, like, sports, I think some of these guys in sports get so wrapped up in the media situation where they should just be like, I'm not looking at any of this shit until the season's done, you know? And there are some guys that do that kind of shit. Like, what's his name? The Beast Mode from Seattle. You know, he kind of keeps himself, and a lot of people gave him flack.
Marshawn Lynch.
Yeah, Marshawn Lynch, okay? So I think it's really unique about him that he does that because... He's like, and then he comes to an interview and he's like, I'm just here because in my contract it says I have to be here.
Yeah. Yeah,
because you know what's unique about it is he's focused on his one thing, playing football. And the thing is all his other bullshit sidetracks him from that. And he's not concerned about that. He's concerned about getting the ball, running it, making scores, and making the fucking game happen. And that's the same thing with this.
You're just doing this because you got to.
I'm playing the shows because I enjoy playing and I like, you know, the end result of the people enjoying it. Is a bonus because when we work on shit, we're working on shit to make us comfortable when we're playing it. You know, we're like, we like how this sounds. We like how this, it's like, I mean, we're not going to write something and be like, oh, this sounds like shit, but the fans will dig it. You know, it's yeah, like, because so, then I get on stage every night and I'm like, oh shit, we got to play this shit again.
Fans are wanting to hear this again. Yes.
Do you always just write the music, perform the music that you guys like, or do you,
well, no,
do
no,
you
no,
ever?
No, 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 because we won't put something on the record unless we like it.
Right, right.
We tear it apart. Like, we'll put whole songs together, and we'll tear the bitch apart. Like, after a while, you know, we'll be jamming it in a room, and then we're like, oh, fuck. I'm not into the vibe of it. It's not coming across right. So we tear it
up. Something, or there's no record label saying, hey, look, this is a good song. You guys are
Record label will be like, so when are y'all planning on thinking on writing? Ah, don't pressure us, man. We're just trying to think things out, and we're a little lazy.
You have the personal integrity or the band integrity, and this is like a rhetorical question because I know the answer, but it's like, there's nobody pressuring you as the artist to put something out. They like, you know what, they think it's a good song, and you guys are like, you know what, it's not our best. And they're like, oh, I think it's going to be a hit. And you're like, no, we're not doing
it.
No,
you know, absolutely. And it's because we want to get up on the stage eventually and play it live nights on end for months on end. And be still comfortable and be like, yeah, this song's fucking awesome to play. Right. This is fucking fun to play. And then the benefit is the fans that actually take it in and they're like, I really like this stuff. So then you get a mutual thing there. And they're like, the crowd's feeding off it. You're excited about it. It pumps it up even more, you know? So it's like, when I go in and I'm working on shit, I'm not thinking about fans and what the media is going to say and what's going on. I'm just like, I like this. I like how things are coming out. Comfortable with this. This is how I like it. This is gonna make me headbang on stage because I'm fucking really into it. You know, not oh I gotta make it through this next 5 minutes on stage because we just put this shit together for whatever.
Right, right. No, it was more of a question of do you ever get pressure from you know the
no
the
actually you know what I have to say that you know, I mean I don't like labels in certain ways because I feel like they are the reason behind the industry falling apart right now, even though they don't want to accept the responsibility of it because they put out fucking so many fucking records a week and they think that people have $400+ a month to spend on fucking records, you know? It's just like, another fucking political move. Yeah, all these people don't have the money for that shit, you know?
Right.
Yeah. But on the other end, I do have to say that Metal Blade has never been like, hey, you know, y'all have to do this now. They check in and they're like, so what's going on? How are things going? We're working on this. We have a couple of songs. All right, keep doing what you got to do. You know?
That's cool.
Do what you have to do.
That's refreshing me here.
Yeah. I mean, I've heard of bands that have that kind of situation, but we don't have that situation.
Awesome. Yeah. Yeah. It's no secret. I'm not going to take much more of your time after you know, a couple more questions. It's no secret the last year and a half, 2 years in the media on, you know, everything's on fucking Blabbermouth on Twitter, Reddit.
I hate all the drama.
Exactly.
You know?
It's the last
year and a half.
Don't ruin it. Don't ruin it. Get all that bullshit out of there.
It seems like when issues were starting to come to light for people who had no fucking clue. The question.
I'll tell you what, everybody keeps talking about, like, oh, metal's old, metal's dead. It's not. It's always been there. It's still there. It's been going on for fucking 40 years and years. It just goes into the underground and it starts configuring and recreating itself in new ways and comes out, man. Just because it's not in the fucking bulk of everyone's face doesn't mean it's not existent.
Yep.
You know?
Guys like him and I have a 4.5-year-old daughter and one almost 2-year-old son. You got a 1-year-old daughter, and what they're listening to? They're listening to metal.
Yeah, they're listening to you. Worse, I'm spinning your vinyl for my fucking daughter.
Yeah.
Okay. We're keeping it alive.
Yeah, we're keeping it alive.
It's like, I don't know. These people are just, you know what the problem is? Is because they're not making money from it or enough money from it, and so then they got to shoot it down in some sort of way.
Yeah.
And it's like, come on, dude. It's just like, whatever. Like the whole thing that happened with the Mayhem Fest, I was just like, that is just fucking ridiculous.
Right.
You know, that's just fucking absurd. To open your mouth. But you know what? At the same time,
what did you think about Kerry King coming out,
I think it's, you know, he's definitely proper for stepping up and saying something about the guy, because the guy's like basically shooting down the whole thing that he created. Not only that, you know what? Through the years, any festival, it happened to fucking
about,
Oz.
Are you talking about the? I forget his name, but the guy who actually put on the festival.
Yeah.
You're talking about him?
The one who called Mayhem about heavy metal fans, old, fat, and you know, whatever.
You know what? As a business move, he should have never done that, you know, because that is his thing, his creation. He should be behind 100%, okay? But at the same time, you know, yes, I appreciate Kerry King coming out and stating that too. All that should have just been left till the end of the fucking tour. But still,
but at the same time,
I fault bigger bands like Slayer and all that too for not supporting the younger bands out there working to build the scene still. You know, it's like you are getting older. No offense, but you're getting older. You did create records like Rain and Blood, Season of the Beast, you know, things like that, that definitely brought things further ahead and created fucking things for people to build off of. But you know what? You have to get the next generation ready and keep building
it.
So it's up to you to step in there and look at these bands. And don't say you don't like anything new coming out. Sit back and step away for a while and check out what's going out there. Because there's a lot of fucking good bands out there, you know? And examine them and see it and be like, hey, we need to bring these bands out because they need to keep the banner rolling after we can't fucking do it anymore.
I can't agree enough with everything you just said, because the guy who started Mayhem Fest shouldn't not have said that we're a bunch of old, because he's talking about me. We're a bunch of old.
He's talking about me too. Yeah. I'm 42.
You know, 1972,
1973.
So I'm a little
old. You're a little bit old. Relax.
Well, it's not a battle of fucking kids. But I also agree with Kerry King in a way that I love Slayer, and anytime Slayer, when the Mayhem Fest
came
through.
No, I agree. This is the same. I'm agreeing with him saying that about the guy.
No, yeah, so, I'm agreeing with everything you said.
I'm just saying that him as being Kerry King from Slayer should step up to the plate now and be like, I'm going to start bringing out these younger bands to keep the banner going. Because no one else will ever write Rain and Blood. It will never happen. It was a moment. It was immense. It was incredible. I got a 0 in fucking PE class that day because me and 3 friends were listening to it on a fucking cassette tape. Okay? Yes. It was immense. It was great.
Cassette tape, because the whole album was on one side of the cassette tape.
And you flip it, it would play. So it was a moment. You can't duplicate that moment, but the newer generation can create a new moment that happens like that. Okay?
But yeah,
so you can't. You can't duplicate. Kids won't be able to get a 0 in class over Rain and Blood anymore, you know? Yeah. Because it happened at a certain point in time. But kids in class can have a 0 in a class listening to something new that came out that totally fucking makes something happen, you know? So I think some of the older guys just need to step up and be like, you know, we have to open up to keep the scene alive and to keep the metal scene moving forward. That's how it's not going to die, is if they all stand up and go, we're going to do this and make things happen.
Be united, together, everyone, rather than just trying to, like, I felt like this Mayhem Fest is like trying to split the metal community.
Well, you know what, like they said, I remember reading about all this shit, like, Mayhem Fest is the last year, it's dead. And the same thing happened to Ozfest. I don't know why people acted so fucking weird. It got to a point where it just didn't do good somewhere.
so much anymore, you know? I think it gets to a point where it's like, all right, you know what? We need to give America a break for like 4 years.
Yeah, bring it back.
Because this shit's just not... Last year, I mean, through people and things like that, I heard last year didn't do so well. So why would you go into another year after last year didn't do so well? Because somebody's fucking greedy.
Right.
So end it. Give it a break.
Let America like go away for like 15 years, and now they're coming back.
Yep. Well, George, last one. We're running a little late on time. What do you got?
Before we go, I just wanted to ask: Soylent Green, can we expect anything ever? I mean, you know, are you guys still planning on doing something? It's been a while, and I miss you. I miss you.
I don't really have an answer for that, dude. It's like it's not. I'm gonna throw this card down. I'm just a singer, dude.
That's cool. I just couldn't be like, here and not ask
okay,
it.
Let me say this. Like, Brian, he plays in IAGOD. IAGOD's doing a lot of stuff. Yeah. Tommy plays in Crowbar. Crowbar's doing a lot of stuff. I play with Goatwhore. We're doing a lot of stuff. And, yes, I'm just a singer. I never really wrote any music for Soylent except for lyrics and vocals, okay? So those guys build the music, and then I build everything. So it's like... I just tell them, when you're ready, I'm fucking ready to do whatever. I would do it. I enjoy.
Bring out the fucking General Lee. I'm ready.
I enjoy doing both because, you know, people that are outside of metal would listen to it and be like, I don't see the difference. But it was a huge difference for me. The styles were different. The lyrical content was really different. And that's, you know, a big thing that I had going on.
Well, thanks a lot for coming on with us. And it was a real pleasure.
Yeah.
Truly, it's an honor.
I appreciate talking into that cougar bush, too. Yeah. Man.
This next interview, Buke was flying solo. This is with the guys from Mutoid Man.
Hey, this is Buke from the Metalheads podcast. I am joined with who I have been waiting the whole fucking day to talk to, Mutoid Man. Gentlemen, how's everything going?
Excellent, man. How about you?
Going wonderful. It's a long fucking hot day. But please, tell everyone listening, who am I talking to? Your guys' names and what you guys do in the band.
My name is Steve Brodsky. I play guitar and sing and make an asshole of myself.
My name's Nick Caggio. I play bass. I occasionally make pterodactyl noises, and I play skin flute occasionally.
We all do.
I'm Ben from Mutoid Man, and I play drums, and I can't think of a good joke because I'm really tired.
It's okay. First thing I have to ask, this is the fucking nerd in me. Does your guy's name come from a video game reference?
Yes, sir.
Sure does.
Fucking knew it. Yes. Whose naming was that? Who can we credit with that name?
Well, at some point, Ben and I were trying to come up with a better name than Narcoleptic Beagle, which is really hard because Narcoleptic Beagle is fucking amazing.
And I have a beagle. That's awesome.
Is it narcoleptic?
Nah.
Maybe? A little bit?
He actually does have seizures.
Oh, shit.
Now I'm
Dude,
actually...
You asshole?
Yeah, you fucking asshole.
Sorry, I went to a dark place.
Insensitive.
No. But no. You know what, though? Put that on the fucking shirt. And anytime he goes into a seizure, I'll Instagram you.
There you go. All right. Tag me.
Tag you. Exactly.
Yeah, so Mutoid Man is the boss character in a game called Smash TV. It's the first boss. He's a fucking half man, half tank. He's a hard son of a bitch to beat. Fucking takes several quarters in the arcade to knock that fucker down. So it seemed like a good fit for our band.
That's awesome. To our listeners who haven't heard us talking on the podcast enough about you guys' most recent album has been getting constant spins. A lot of critical acclaim. Has that taken you guys off guard at all?
No, not at all. I mean, we're just going to do our thing and see what happens. We try not to really pay too much attention to, you know, all that stuff. Maybe a little bit, but we're mostly just there to play as hard as we can at every show. You know, if there's fucking 20 people or 2,000 people, it doesn't matter. We're just there to play the songs because we fucking love the songs. We love the band. So happy with how the record came out. And we're just here to spread the gospel across the world. We're in the middle of our world tour right now, so the main goal is just play as hard as we can every night.
Preach it!
Exactly. Your guys' energy on stage, amazing. Fucking amazing live.
A lot of bands lack that these days, and you go up there and you see them performing fretboard acrobatics and all this technical shit that nobody really cares about, but there's no, it's not fun to watch. It's like, would you pay $7 to go see, you know, a shitty movie in the theater? And then why would you pay $7 to go see a band that just stands there and they don't look like they're having fun?
You know, it's funny you say that. Last year we saw Black Crown Initiate. They put out an amazing album last year. but maybe because they're new to the whole playing live thing, they kind of stood there like statues the whole time. You guys were playing under that, whatever you want to call it, gazebo?
The Slutman Pavilion.
Yeah, exactly. Last year, Iron Reagan played under that, and they had fucking people hanging from the rafters.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and that's why they covered it up today, so people couldn't be hanging from there. But you guys had the fucking place going crazy. You guys look like you were playing for 10,000 people. You don't get that a lot in music today. At all. So, when you guys got approached to do GWARBQ here, this is 30 years for them as a band. Were you guys GWAR fans before this?
Huge. Huge, huge fucking GWAR fans.
Yeah, it was a no-brainer, man. Just so, like, we immediately said yes. You know, my other band, Converge, did a tour called Sounds of the Underground many years ago, and GWAR played, and they're just such nice guys, such a great band. Their hearts and their heads are in all the right places. They're just so cool, so it's a no-brainer to play this, for sure.
At 32 years old, GWAR was always one of those bands that you always heard of them. You have to go see GWAR. You have to go see GWAR. And unfortunately, I feel like an asshole saying this, I didn't go till last year's GWARBQ after Brocky died. Yeah, so I missed them for so many years. You guys are from
New York, yeah. I've seen GWAR probably 10 times, dude.
They were always one of that band. Oh, I'm seeing them next time. I'll see them. After seeing them last year, I fucking missed everything. Because they're one of those bands on stage just laughing and enjoying it the whole fucking time.
And they're incredible musicians, too. It's
exactly.
Like, people think they're like this gimmicky, jokey, whatever, but they're actually like, they're all shredders. They all play their asses off in fucking insane costume. Like, it's it's awesome. It's what the entertainment industry should fucking live up to.
Yeah. Now, to a lot of people, your other band, or your former band, Converge.
Converge.
A lot of people, you know, swear by them. They're one of their favorite bands, you know, of all time. Your experience playing with Mutoid Man here, does it kind of allow you to maybe do something that you wanted to do for years before you started this?
I mean, musically, I guess it's, you know, there's more of like a rock and roll influence, so there's definitely less, you know, locked in, like, technical, you know, parts that you have to really just sort of focus on, and there's not a lot of room for embellishment a lot of the time. So with this band, there's a lot of parts you can really just lay into and have a lot of fun with. There's the technical parts, but there's also the just really fun rock and roll parts. I think that's a big difference, too.
That's a great way to put it. Your guys' sound is accessible. Very, very much so. In this genre, you always wonder, would you start somebody new with? You know, new to the genre, or what do you kind of introduce them with? Your guys' album's a great example of that. This is a great gateway drug.
Cool.
To put it at that.
No one here has cocaine.
You ask everybody here?
I've asked everybody here.
So, what's your guys' plans coming up? I know you guys still wrote Road Dogs.
Finishing up this North American tour till August 6th. September 6th. And then most of September off, and then Europe in October, and a little bit of November, UK and Europe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jeez. Wow.
And then Japan, and then Australia, and then New Zealand, and then the moon with Lars Ulrich.
Mm-hmm. We're fucking conquering it all. I have to ask you guys about your guys' album artwork. I'm a big vinyl guy. Your guys' artwork's cool. Who did your guys' album art?
John Santos. He's a lovely gentleman, Johnny Santos. And he did the first Helium Head EP for us as well. He's just a really cool artist. I met him on tour when Converge was touring with Torch, and he was doing their merch. And I looked at the Torch album, Meanderthal, I think is the album that he did. And I was just like, holy shit, this artwork is so fucking awesome. Do you know who did it? And oh, sorry. Yeah. Harmonicraft is the record.
It's okay. I'm a mush mouth. Yeah, you're.
It had like a, you know, Salvador Dali weird thing going on, like totally psychedelic. And I was like, whoa, who did that artwork? And he's like, that was me. I was like, whoa, nice. I got a new band. Yeah. Like, would you be into it? And he was totally into it. And he did the Helium Head EP. And yeah, he's like our puss head.
That's yeah, fucking awesome. So another member of our podcast sent me a couple questions. So I would, it would be disrespectful of me not to ask him his fucking questions that he took the time to write. It's been a long fucking day for me too. Fucking, if you traffic in this area is fucking brutal. I know you guys from the city are no strangers to that.
Not even 2:30 yet. Gear up, man.
Gear up. Yeah. You guys pulling out of here afterwards, or you guys?
I want to watch Down and Cro-Mags and Descendants and Gwar, so yeah, we'll stick around.
For the long haul, man.
Is there any bands in the scene right now putting out anything that has you guys really excited? Maybe the last year or so that's come out that you guys are pretty hooked on?
I don't listen to too much heavy stuff these days. I'm so busy like with my own bands and listening to demos and trying to like figure that shit out. And then a lot of times I just want to listen to podcasts and not music, like when I'm driving. But
any podcasts you listen to? Because that's me. I'm a big video game guy.
Joe Rogan Experience, What the Fuck Pod with Mark Maron, Tim Ferriss podcast, This American Life. There's so many good ones.
Let me suggest a good one for you guys. Last Podcast on the Left.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, these guys, they talk about serial killers and crazy conspiracy stuff. They're a bunch of stand-up comics. It's fucking great.
Going Off Track, which we just did a little while ago, is a great one. Yeah, with our friend Jonah Bayer.
You guys ever thought about doing something?
What's that?
Do you guys ever thought about doing a podcast?
It would be so fun. I would love to do it.
We'd probably be really stupid at it.
Yeah, and that's what's great
about it. That's what's fucking great. You need a mic.
You want.
Exactly. You do whatever you want. We
could say Dolphin Cum and GoPro just infinitely.
YouTube, Sergeant House.
GoPro.
Yeah.
Go.
Yeah. We'll see if my burger's right
there. Yeah. Right, that's how you get fucking Reddit votes. You say stupid shit like that, you make a GIF about it, boom. You're blowing up.
Yeah, this life is stupid. You don't want to do stupid shit.
So, again, my friend Jay from the podcast wanted me to ask you guys, the current tour features Wild Throne as openers. Did you seek them out, or is it set up for you guys?
We played with them in Seattle, and they're a fucking rad band. They got a new record coming out. It might already be out. It just made sense. Musically, we're kind of on a similar path. They're a power trio like us. So, yeah, I think it's a really good combo.
Power trios of the world unite.
You guys have a favorite one?
Power trios?
Yeah.
There's the go-tos, you know, there's the Nirvanas and Blink-182, obviously.
Obviously. Graham, you know, I recently got into vinyl, like I told you guys, and that was one of the first, he's brought in a burger, that's glorious. That was one of the first vinyl that I bought, the Graham Funk Live or something. You seem like you can go to any record store and find that album. Okay. Are Converge and Cave-In fans coming to the shows?
Yeah, I think so. A lot of that.
Yeah, I see some Converge shirts. I see some Cave-In shirts. I got people asking me, you know, what's going on with Cave-In. Yeah, I mean, there's plenty about Mutoid Man that, you know, sort of reflects elements of Cave-In, as well as Converge. So there's plenty of stuff in this band for, you know, fans of those bands to latch on to. So, and it's all good by me, you know?
Yeah.
Yep. And is it true that you found your guy's bass player while he was doing sound at the St. Vitus show?
We found him in a ditch. He was in a ditch, and we, you know, looked like he needed some water, some food.
He was really
See, gross. I'd be asking him, but he's chowing down on his burger and fries.
I needed some sweet, tender loving. Once they realized I was better than Billy Sheehan, they put the call in, and I came in and came all over the songs.
Yeah. And were you giving them then sounds on tips like, hey, you guys sound a little off on here, or maybe you could tweak this, or
no?
Yeah.
I don't have an ear for that. I don't even know how any of this actually really happened. I'm a terrible sound engineer. And I'm a pretty poor bass player, so it's just kind of an anomaly to me.
Well, his one talent is that he can play Sailing the Seas of Cheese front to back in its entirety without missing a beat, and that was the only criteria we really wanted in a bass player. So,
yeah. And on top of that, as a bass player too, does a three-piece maybe kind of move him a little more to the forefront?
Nah.
No.
Nah, he still plays behind the curtain. And he pays us to be in the band. We don't pay him.
I pay them $100 a day to play with them.
Each.
Each. Yeah. And other favors we can't talk about here. And any other bands you guys are hoping to tour with coming up?
Metallica, Slayer, Mastodon, Baroness, fucking...
Megadeth,
Anthrax.
Yeah.
Anthrax, yep, yep, yep.
We said Slayer.
Cher.
Cher. Yeah, well, why not? You know, we'll branch out a little bit.
Why not?
You know? Yes. TJ, man, that guy still has a great voice. I'd love to play with TJ. Elvis Presley impersonators. Eric Burdon from The Animals.
Ooh, that one. Yeah.
Now, you guys doing different sounds in these bands now. Is there any other projects that you have cooking in your head that maybe you can try this type of band now? Maybe a jazz project or something fucking crazy and off the wall.
Jazz is fun, but it's way too self-serving for me, I think. No one wants to fucking watch jazz.
It's like tap dancing.
Who wants to watch tap dancing?
Yeah, people doing it.
Shit's over, man. But, you know, The Advantage, one of our favorite bands, they seem to have kind of sort of disappeared, you know? But they've done some of the best sort of Nintendo cover versions of songs, and so we're starting to pick up on that a little bit, threw in a little Contra, Aliens Lair.
Now, you guys having a name from a video game character, are you guys all gamers? Because that's... You don't have to hide it. It's okay. We're not nerds.
It's more of like an appreciation for like 8-bit and 16-bit games.
Some would say the finer things in life.
Yeah, exactly. Like I don't really have time to play much video games these days, which sucks, but it's still fun to bust out the 8-bit games every once in a while. A little punch out.
Yeah. So you don't like a game unless you have to blow in it to make it work.
Exactly.
You know? Yeah.
Exactly. You gotta work for it, man.
Do you guys have the ability on the road? Do you guys bring TVs and stuff with you guys to play?
I have an emulator for Nintendo and Super Nintendo and a modded USB Super Nintendo controller so I can play any game for NES and Super NES that's ever been invented right on my laptop. It's amazing.
Oh, that's awesome.
I have an old 26-inch tube TV that's in a road case. You know, once I get the antennas right and get that signal going.
We used to do that.
We had an old fucking tube TV. We put it in the back bench, hook up the PlayStation. It's so stupid.
You guys have a favorite game of all time?
What?
You have a favorite game?
Ooh, that's tough, man.
Yeah.
That's tough.
Yeah. I'd have to... Super Mario Kart. That shit's just fun.
Okay,
shit.
For the 64 or for the Super NES?
Like the original one. It's just so much fun. Actually, and not complicated.
Yeah. Speaking of that, I think Mario Kart for Wii might be my favorite game of all time.
Really?
Yeah, playing the... worldwide competitive, you know, versus play. Yeah. We get on Wi-Fi and play like dudes in Japan who just destroy you.
Destroy
it was
you.
So fun.
They're power sliding around the whole fucking thing. You're like...
Mega Man 2.
You know... That's a good one. That is a good one.
Really amazing game. You know, 1 was good, but like 2 is just on a whole other level. The soundtrack's great. You know, I joined a Facebook page. I pride myself being really good at Mega Man 2. So... You know, there's a community out there. And I'm
You ever watch those guys speed running these games?
My brother Andrew does that shit fucking... Like, he'll beat the whole game in like 13 minutes. And one time, we got this... I think it's still on YouTube. He learned the first two levels so perfectly that he turned away from the TV. He wasn't looking, and he knew exactly when to hit every single button to finish the level in like fucking... It's ridiculous.
You guys, if you are not familiar with it, need to go on Twitch. It's a video game streaming thing. Put your guys selves out there. Get your fans aboard. Get you guys watching yourselves playing some Mega Man.
I have the Twitch app on my phone.
I
didn't need to try it.
I stream a lot, but because I'm not some girl with my tits out or some guy yelling crazy fucking like... Yeah. Yeah. So, with all that said, going...
This dude right here. Human Furnace. Greatest guys ever.
So, this is crazy.
Hey.
Come on, say hey.
Hey.
Hey, there he is.
Hi. How you doing?
great to see you again. I've never seen you. I've seen you live, not met you.
Sucks to be you.
Oh, shit.
I'm joking. I know, brother. Jimmy, very nice to meet you, Matt.
Jimmy, we met before invited.
Yes, yes, sir.
What's up, Steve? Know, great man. To meet you.
Yeah, Jimmy, what's up with the cane? You got a bad knee or something?
My dick's too big. Yeah!
That's famous last words. Those guys are fucking crazy, huh?
Yeah, we got to play Bury Me in Smoke when Converge played with them at a festival. We got to finish it off. Like, they let bands come up and play the end of the song, and they, like, wave goodbye to the crowd. It's so fun, man.
Is that because they fucking were so gone that they're like, please come up and help us? Please help us.
Yeah, we got to give the crowd some love properly, man. They can't play instruments while they do that, you know?
Was Kirk with them at the time?
Yeah.
That guy was awesome. Okay, well, gentlemen, I truly, anything else you guys are on tour the rest of the, you know, month,
on
next
tour.
Month?
Yep. Mutoidman.com, get all the info, come see us.
I truly appreciate you guys for the time. Thank you very much.
It was truly an honor and a privilege to perform this next interview. The three of us posed some questions to Beefcake the Mighty of Gwar. Miraculously, he allowed us to live.
Yeah, we'll keep it true. Okay, here we are. This is the Metalheads Podcast with the fucking famous Beefcake. Talk into the cougar pussy.
Hey, this is Beefcake the Mighty from Gwar. I'm famous, and I'm rich, too.
Yeah.
And I'll turn you out. I'll fuck you and rape you and kill you and like that.
What brings you to Earth today?
I've been on Earth, a fucking stupid place for millennia. I can't fucking leave.
Please tell me what it's like living in Antarctica, coming from Antarctica, and the only animals down there are penguins to fuck. What is that like?
Well, there's Nazis. You know, there's a whole troop of Nazis down there. They're fun. They wear lederhosen.
Oh.
You know, so they're entertaining.
Are they lederhosen with assless chaps?
I probably, yeah, you know.
Yes. They're okay. Fucking goose stepping.
They
everything.
Do over there.
Yeah. So here we are, GWARBQ 2015.
Yes.
30 years of fucking GWAR.
I can't do math.
Have you taken a step back and to fucking realize the magnitude of GWAR and the impact they've had?
I know the magnitude of GWAR. We're the most amazing thing that you've ever seen. I don't need to step back and look at that. I mean, just look at you, fucking slime.
All right.
You know?
Here's
the
question.
The fuck? Look at me.
Yeah.
You guys suck.
Look at us. We're all right. I want to know, worthy. After 30 years, is Pookie still alive?
And Pookie was never alive.
All right.
The fucking song's called Dead Dog.
That's true.
Right. Let me
let me rephrase the question. Are you guys still fucking Pookie?
Of course.
Okay.
It never stops.
Is Pookie still around, I guess is my question.
He's around. He gets around. He's a whore.
Yeah.
Fuck this is awesome. Fuck him all the time.
So, GWARBQ 2015.
That's right.
You guys are back again.
That's right.
Hadad's Lake.
Right.
You guys have had a fucking crazy couple years.
Yes.
How is Gwar's band doing now?
We're doing what we always do, you know. You can't really stop Gwar. We're a primal force. And, you know, the GWARBQ is amazing. You've got nice sauce to put on meat. Got,
I saw that.
You got like,
I need to buy a bottle.
You got like people swimming and rope swinging and fucking sucking each other off and raping squirrels. I don't fucking know what's going on around here.
Have you tasted this earthly concept of beer? And more importantly, have you tasted the Gwar beer, the odorous ale this year?
Yes, I did. It's delicious. It tastes just like odorous.
Is it the only thing you can find redeeming about the planet Earth?
No, I mean,
that's
you know.
That's a touchy question. Earth has something, right?
Earth has a lot of delicacies. You know, as you can see, I come from the planet cholesterol, which is... which we love our delicacies and...
I look at our host here, George.
I think yes. I visited it once or twice.
Yes, I think you were born there. For people who can't see, this guy's fat.
So, what do you got to say to the people that, you know, after Odorous went back to home, and the naysayers who said that Gwar was done, what do you say to those people?
I say...
Go fuck a penguin?
Yeah, you could do that. I say, fuck you. I don't give a shit about you. You know?
I like that answer.
Suck it.
Yeah.
Die. You know, that's what I always say.
We were here last year, and it was fucking amazing, and we expect no less today. So
that's right. Well, it will be amazing. I'm here, so.
He's here. Well, of course.
You're already off to a good start.
So, what are the future plans for Gwar moving ahead? Any new albums?
I don't know. Last time we fucked with the future, Volvatron showed up. So.
Oh, that was... Whoa! Yeah, we will not mention that because that seems like that was a fucking...
But her tits were better than yours. You have to admit.
I don't know.
Well, they are pretty nice.
Take this off. You'll see some...
In this internet generation we live in, every rumor was spread about that mess.
Right.
Yeah, we will.
I love it. Yeah. Gossip and hate. It's wonderful.
Just one of the many services you offer.
Right.
I'm sorry. Get it together.
I'm sorry.
He's so ecstatic to be right next to me right now.
We are. That is actually true.
The puny humans that we are, we tremble in fear before your greatness.
Right.
We are not worthy.
No.
So, here we are, GWARBQ, again.
Here we
30
are.
Years.
Face to face. A couple of silver spoons. What do you want?
You have a new singer in one, Blothar.
Right.
How's he fit in so far?
He's bloated. Just look at him.
He
what
is
a sack of grease.
He is.
He makes you look small.
He's
right.
A large fucking alien.
Yes.
So has the sort of battle for control, has that been settled or is that still going on?
I think we're going to Rochambeau for it.
Last year, you guys were pretty, taking each other out on stage, trying to decide who was going to be in charge.
See, when we're not on stage, it's a real hate fest. I call it fat on fat violence.
There's no loser there.
No,
because
that's what happens to the podcast, but I'm not involved.
Yeah, because it's all fat and sweaty and gross and
yes,
yeah.
In your time spending on planet Earth in Richmond, motherfucking Virginia,
yes,
have you found the beer that is suitable for your taste here when you have to, like, succumb yourself to be in Richmond, Virginia?
I mean, Gwar beer, order to sale. What do you want me to shill somebody else's beer? It's our shit. Buy our shit. Come on.
Well, this guy makes beer, so.
Yeah. He's a brewer.
Yeah, well, if you made... Make me money. I'll drink your beer. What the fuck?
You don't add nothing to him.
I can't conceive of that.
Unless you're brewing it at fucking Antarctic temperatures and bringing something to the table.
Frost brewed, cold filtered.
That's Coors Light.
Oh, that's your favorite.
Oh, John. Okay.
That'd be Antarctic beer.
All right. Well.
Yeah. We're all getting the hook. It's a pleasure to talk to you.
Sir.
Yeah,
thank you for speaking to us today.
Thank you.
Yeah, fuck you too.
Yep. It's an honor.
Hey, if you wait for 2 minutes, he's going to blow you, okay?
Yeah. I don't know. He's kind of ugly.
Hello, once again, everyone. This is George. I'm currently flying solo during the clutch set. Will is off somewhere in the crowd. Buke went off to go to the bathroom and hasn't returned yet, so who knows where he is, Mr. Sociable. I'm just sitting here checking out Clutch, having an odorous ale and enjoying the sights and sounds of GWARBQ. Let me tell you, it's been one heck of a day. We've interviewed a few people since last we spoke. We talked to Jeff and Chris from Troglodyte. And we interviewed Ben from Goatwhore, and Buke went off and did a solo interview with Mutoid Man while Will and I were watching Goatwhore. And then the three of us managed to sit down for an interview. Well, sit down. We stood with an interview with Gwar that was pretty interesting. You'll be hearing all of that. I gotta say, it's been a pretty damn fine day. The weather's a little warm, but you know, at least it's sunny, it's not raining, everybody's having a good time. It's definitely a lot better than last year in terms of getting around and lines and things like that. It's pretty easy to get into the bathroom, pretty easy to get beer and water. They're giving away the free water, which has been a lifesaver given the heat.
Even the food lines, there's more food trucks this time, so it's pretty easy to get food too. So, you know, there's been really no complaints. We've all been having a blast, and after Clutch finishes up, we'll be getting into Gwar. Looking at the schedule, I noticed that the Descendants are actually playing after Gwar, so that'll be interesting. But I can see them setting up the Gwar stage now, so I'm sure we'll be getting into that in roughly a half hour or so. So I thought I'd just take a few minutes and give you a little bit of an update, because we've been so busy that we haven't had a chance to really sit down and do anything. So there you go. Well, I'm sure we'll be incorporating the interviews into this podcast, and you'll be hearing those, whether you maybe you've already heard them. I'm not sure what order it's going to be in, but it'll be in there. And then, of course, I'm sure we'll do a post-GWARBQ breakdown on the ride home tonight, so stick around for that.
So as it turns out, when I did that solo update and said Buke was off at the bathroom and never came back, that was because he managed to pick up another interview on the fly. Here's Buke's interview with Valkyrie.
Okay, this is Buke with the Metalheads Podcast. I'm here with Jake from Valkyrie. How's everything going?
It's great. What a lovely day. Great weather, good friends, everything.
Valkyrie, we tried to catch you guys earlier, but things didn't play out. You guys are one of the albums that's making talk about possibly making our end of year list.
Oh, cool, man. Thanks.
You guys' sound, you have a retro sound, a classic sound.
Yeah.
Was that something you guys went into at the start, trying to go for?
Well, you know, we started out, we just like, let's just play riffs a la what we are 70s heroes. Like, we were just like, really, like starting out, it was like Zeppelin, Sabbath. We did kind of have that main inspiration, but it's obviously, as we've grown in our musical influences, we brought in other things like new wave of British heavy metal and things like that.
Yeah, your guys' riffs are, like when you guys were playing earlier, were fucking killer.
Thank you.
Fucking. Man. You guys could, like, when you, a couple songs you were playing, for a large segments of the song, there was no lyrics, just riffs.
Yeah.
Fucking, you're just sitting there banging your fucking head to your guys' stuff.
That was a lot of fun, yeah.
Yeah, from the D.C. area where we're from, you guys being a local band,
yeah.
You guys ever coming up to our area playing shows?
Well,
or
you know,
once Jack's Close and Empire?
Yeah. We're trying to get up to D.C. We have a friend there, Chris B., the D.C. heavy metal dude. He's trying to get us to show there.
We have a friend, Will Cook. He's actually part of the podcast. He does heavy metal brewery nights.
Okay.
With him. Yeah.
Yeah, we want to come up there soon, for sure, because we haven't been up there since the new album came out. So
yeah.
Yeah, and you know, and we have a strong affinity with D.C. and Maryland doom bands, like Spirit Caravan, Earth Ride, all the Internal Void. Mm-hmm. We love, like, that's been a big inspiration, too, over the years.
We just did a show with Yesterday's Saints the other day, and they were high on you guys, too.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, like Matt, the lead singer, and everything. Huh. What can we expect over the coming year, the rest of the year, next year from you guys?
Scattered shows. It'll be, we're weekend warriors right now, and just random stuff, because my brother, who's also in Valkyrie, is in Baroness, and he's going to be gone because they got a new album coming out. So he's going to be doing their tour cycle. But we're going to be writing new stuff. We're trying to do another album to kind of capitalize on the momentum here and not wait so long. We just want to go ahead and work on some other stuff.
Just like your guy's brother, well, your brother's other band, Baroness, you guys' album art is amazing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You want to quickly talk about that?
Jeremy Hush, you know, he was actually Baroness's merch dude, and but he's been a friend of ours for a long time, and he really captured the essence of what the album was, and we knew he was good at birds, and we wanted to do a Red Tail Hawk on there, and he nailed it. We said, look, the crows, we want crows attacking a Red Tail Hawk, because it's something we see in, like, the region. You see that.
Yeah, you certainly do.
Yeah, and so, like, so it was kind of, like, reflected, like, the place we come from, like, a rural, you know, environment, and also the it's called Shadows. So it's like, those are the shadows. The crows are the shadows. So it worked really well. I was really happy with it.
Amazing.
It really
here we are, GWARBQ. It's GWAR's 30th anniversary. You guys being local Commonwealth boys.
Sure.
Have you seen GWAR in the past?
No, this is my first time.
Are you serious?
Yeah, no.
Really?
Well, yeah, but I mean, it was, I was 10. My sister had the America Must Be Destroyed album. I remember sitting in the back seat of my mom's car, listening on the headphones and reading the lyric sheet and being like, I hope my mom does not find this. It was the most depraved stuff I'd ever seen in my life. So, it, you know, they've always held a special place.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Oh, my gosh. No. Yeah. So it, I don't take it for granted that we're here at all, man.
It's amazing. And these, and we've talked to so many bands here. In addition to talking to Gwar, they are extremely humble.
Oh, sure.
They realize that everything they've achieved is from being so down to earth and just, like you guys, being out there, accessible to fans.
Yeah.
You know, playing all the time, you know. Lastly, I'll let you go. Your guys' album has achieved a lot of critical success.
Sure.
Have you heard any of that? Has it affected your guys? Gotten in your heads at all?
We've been pleasant. I mean, it's been nice to hear like mostly positive reviews and
Amazing stuff.
I mean, we're happy with the way it was received for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's such a great classic sound, but then the constant riffs you guys add in is just different, too.
Well, thanks. I mean, one thing, there's a lot of bands basically doing 70s tribute bands right now, and there's also a lot of bands doing the dark occult vibe. And so one thing we don't do the dark occult vibe. We try not to just be solely a retro band. Like, we have our influence, but we see ourselves as a modern band with certain influences. So I think it stands out a little bit from a lot of the stuff out there just because of that. It's a positive. And that is one thing Valkyrie prides itself on, is just being positive at the end of the day. Like, that's what we do. We're not about the darkness, really.
Especially,
it's there, but...
And that's what comes through in your guys' music, especially... In this scene right now, it seems like the current flavor of the month, doom.
Oh yeah.
Old classic doom, like your Pentagram.
Oh yeah, that's
like
that's
your
heavy
old Trouble.
Influence for us, sure.
Yeah, like those sounds are really coming back, but it sounds like you guys are putting your own spin on that.
Well, that's
too.
The cool thing about doom metal. They good doom metal like Sabbath, whatever, Trouble, they recognize the dark and the light. They give credence to each. Recognize the power on each side, and then you play off of that. And that, so Sabbath has those dynamics. They're doomy as shit, but then they have the positive aspects of it and the major key parts. Yep. So we try to do that too. Yeah.
You guys, I'm telling you, to our listeners, if you have not purchased Valkyrie's album out right now, please do yourself a favor. Buy it right now. If not for the album art alone, fucking buy these guys. The fucking riffs, I'm not talking bad about them, but if you're saying to yourself, "Oh, High on Fire has ripped," no, buy Valkyrie. Truly.
Jeez,
anything
that's
you
awesome.
Want to say else in closing?
Thanks a lot. No, just thanks a lot. We appreciate everybody that appreciates what we're doing, man.
Thanks again. This is Buke for Metalheads Podcast.
And that concludes our interviews from GWARBQ. Again, thank you to everyone that spoke with us. We really appreciated your time. This last section of the episode chronicles our drive home from the show and our post-mortem of the day. It was a long day and we ramble all over the place, so please excuse us. And lo and behold, Jay makes a surprise appearance too.
Hello, ladies and gents. We're back.
GWARBQ is in the books.
It is in the books. GWARBQ 2015. We are done. We are on the way home. And, what a glorious day it was indeed. I know I did a little couple of minute bit while the guys were otherwise occupied, but I think we're going to probably go back into that in a little more detail. So last time we talked as a group, it was just prior to meeting with Troglodyte. And we had a rather lengthy conversation with them, as you will or have already heard. What are your thoughts on Troglodyte there, Buke?
Classic death metal. They came out right at the start in their Bigfoot masks. And they fucking kicked off the GWARBQ great. They're fucking wonderful to walk into and walk right into those guys starting it off.
Face first into brutality.
Yeah. It was cool.
So, what'd you think of the interview we did with them?
Set the tone for the whole day of a bunch of great interviews that it was, as you've heard or will hear, it was not your standard, hey, what's this song about or what's the album about? Tell us your history. It was a lot of strange, fun, interesting Bigfoot talk, because that's what their subject matter is. Talked about the guys a little bit about the whole Kansas City scene. Talked to them about a little bit about Gwar. They had some experience in the past with Dave. They would hit on that. It was really interesting.
And we heard that they are, in fact, working on a new album that they hope to have out later in the fall. Hopefully, as you will hear, they might come back on and do an interview on the podcast with us when that is released. So that'd be cool. Let's get Will's thoughts on Troglodyte.
I absolutely love Troglodyte, and I'm only disappointed that when after we interviewed them, well, I should say before we interviewed them, and then after we interviewed them, they promised me a sticker, but they could not find a sticker. I want a sticker.
Will did not get his lollipop, and he's mad.
Yeah, sorry, I'm being very simplistic, but I'll say this about Troglodyte. What we said earlier on, I heard them for about 3 seconds, and I was instantly hooked. And after talking to Chris and Jeff from Troglodyte, it was the weirdest but greatest interview ever. Like, they are very deadpan. They are what they are. It was just the worst thing to say, but like they were great. They were great. And I'll spend the entire time just looking at Chris, who's the drummer, and just watching his reactions to everything that he says.
That Jeff said,
it was phenomenal. So,
Jeff was a very interesting guy. Perfect for a front man, honestly. He, aside from the fact that he fucking has a great voice for the death metal, the death metals that are on the interwebs, and but like you said, the deadpan, just the way that he speaks and the sense of humor that he had was just fucking, it was really cool, and definitely I liked them a lot. And I can't wait for the new album.
They're definitely aware of what their shtick is.
Yes, absolutely.
And, you know, they don't shy away from that, which was cool. You know, they are a classic death metal band with a subject matter of Bigfoot. They all wear Bigfoot masks.
Yep.
With long hair or long dreads, you know, they're fucking great.
So, woohoo, bumpy road. So, another band that we really liked was a band called Gritter. And none of us really knew who they were, nope. but they came out and they fucking tore it up, man. I'm going to be looking for some of that.
Yeah, they were a total unknown to us. And they came out and they sounded fucking great.
They came, they saw, they kicked our ass.
Yep.
I cannot disagree with that at all. Gritter was phenomenal. But my question is, where are we going right now?
The ramp was closed, so we're still
getting on 95.
We are trying to get home. They don't seem to want us to get there.
We're getting there now.
Where are we heading south? Heading south right now, right?
No, we're getting on 95 North right now.
Right now.
Doing bridge work.
Hopefully there's an express lane or something.
Later on.
All right, did you want to talk about Gritter more?
They're awesome. I love them. Never heard of them before. Instant fan.
All right.
The thing I want to say about them is another perfect example of why coming to these festivals I enjoy so much is that nine times out of ten, you leave with that one band you've never heard before, don't have a clue about, and you leave being a fan of them. So,
yeah, excellent. I'm definitely going to be looking them up tomorrow. So then, of course, we saw Valkyrie, and Buke got a chance to talk to them later on. But Valkyrie was one of the bands that we learned about them a few months ago, sort of right before Deathfest, I think. And, you know, they're a local doom band that, if you have not heard, you really should check them out. They're pretty, pretty damn good.
Members of Baroness.
Yep. And it's not like Candlemass slow, trudgy doom. It's, you know, it's got clean vocals, but that it's a bit more upbeat. So
there's also a cool retro sound to it.
Yeah, definitely. There's a lot. If you like guitar playing, you should definitely check them out.
Were the two guitar players twins?
I didn't notice.
I thought they were. Yeah.
Will, any comment on Valkyrie?
Just that they were awesome. I love them. A new band. I had no idea they were from Virginia, which was an added bonus. Yeah, definitely was liking Valkyrie.
Right on. Okay, so then we sort of split up a little bit, and Buke and I got hot dogs, and Will. Will talked to so many people today. It was ridiculous. It's like, how do you know all these people? They're all brewers, of course. But,
yeah, Will took GWARBQ today and turned it into a networking event.
And I thought that was what we were supposed to do.
Yeah. Will, did you hand out any cards on our behalf?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I did a few. But you have to understand, like, so... Like, if I meet another brewer, the first thing we do is we talk about beer. This was, it's more about beer than it is about the metal. But if you are here, like, I am a heavy metal brewer. And I did find, I would say a couple of the other brewers that I know who are definitely in the metal. So, Mike Hillier from Strange Ways and the guys from Scar City, like, we had a good time. Like, we, like, it was about the beer. It was about the beer, it was about the metal. I'm more about the metal than they are in some aspects, but I spent in the clutch pit, I spent the entire time with Mike Hillier. Like, it was fantastic. That dude, he knew clutch. Love Clutch, two brewers. It was good. It was almost like gay sex.
You get ahead of yourself.
Yeah.
So then there was Ghoul, and they were interesting guys. You
very
know,
interesting.
They come out with like corn sacks.
Yep, burlap bags.
Burlap bags, whatever you want to call them, over their heads like the Scarecrow or something out of like Batman or something. And which is, you know, it's kind of creepy looking, and that's awesome. And they had a stage show that certainly, while not as large or intense as Gwar, they did have, like, some characters and stuff that came out and did some stuff, so it was kind of interesting. I know Buke's been talking Ghoul a lot lately.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't know where Will went during this or if Will saw them, but... Yeah, they put on a pretty cool show.
Yeah, totally. Did you catch them at all?
Barely. I tried to. I don't know. Like, there was, like, a lot of weird stuff going on at that point where I was trying to. Like there's interviews going on, and Buke was trying, like, interview different people. And I was like, hey. And George, you could say, like, I was like, dude, Ghoul is going on. Like, let's go check out Ghoul. And I saw him for, I don't know, a couple minutes.
Yeah. Around this time, there's a lot of stuff.
Yeah, around this time, and I think it was actually before Ghoul.
Just edit all that shit out.
We did some interviews, which I mentioned earlier. We talked to Ben from Goatwhore, and wow, was that an amazing, awesome interview. It was like it was like we knew the guy already. It's like we came in, shook his hand, sat down, and just started bullshitting, as you'll tell from the interview, because we didn't really talk about music all that much.
Nope.
We just sort of talked about stuff, and that it was just so comfortable, and it felt right, and we just went with it, you know.
Yeah, it was a total pleasure to have an interview that, you know, not knowing so much about their history and stuff, to go into it and have it not really be about the band. Not really have it be the same interview you've heard 500 times if you're a fan of the band.
Yeah, and the fact that, you know, we go into these things going, man, are we going to have enough questions to ask, which you'll hear about later, and, you know, they were, like, giving us the, you know, cut off, you know, the... Yep. With the hand across the next sign going, come on, wrap it up. So, you know, it was going well. And so it was a good time.
Yeah, you know who did not do that? Ben. Ben from Goatwhore. Like, that guy, he just seemed like he was so happy to talk to us. And not necessarily talk to us, but just talk in general. He was like, let's just keep talking. Let's talk about metal. Let's talk about... whatever. Like, it was a phenomenal interview that we did with him. Not that it was with us, but it was just like he had a good time. I think he would have talked to us for a lot longer than we did.
Yeah. And, you know, I gotta tell you, it was I want to say it was weird. It was cool that we just sat down and talked to him and whatever, bullshitted, and then like half an hour later he was up on the stage with his fucking gauntlets on, just fucking shredding it. And Buke missed that. Buke was busy doing interviews then, and with Mutoid Man, so unfortunately Buke did not see Goatwhore. Yeah, it was the price to pay for the pod, but we appreciate that, and we enjoyed it with you in mind.
Yeah. Since I missed it, how was Goatwhore live?
It was pretty damn good.
It was
amazing. Yeah.
It was absolutely amazing. Like, the sound quality of Goatwhore tonight at the GWARBQ was spot on. It was really, really, really good.
Fans were pretty into them.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. There was a lot of raised fists and, you know, and, like, some moshing and stuff like that. So it was cool. And then, after that, unfortunately, Will really wanted to see the Cro-Mags. He didn't get to see them. He did get to hear them. But at this point, we were, Buke was done with the interview he was doing. And so we went to go meet up with him so that we could do an interview with Gwar. And
okay, yes. Sorry to interrupt you. Will, we talked about coming down here. Cro-Mags were what you were looking forward to the most.
Well, I should say it was not like I was looking to them the most. It was just that I was excited the fact that I have not seen these guys in like 20 some years. And I would love absolutely to see the Cro-Mags. But I'm a very specific Cro-Mags fan. I love Best Wishes, their second album. So it's not like I am a... I do not love everything that they did, but to explain all this away, we waited and we interviewed Beefcake the Mighty from Gwar. So I will give up seeing Cro-Mags to interview Beefcake the Mighty.
How cool was that? Did anybody in here ever think we'd actually sit down and shoot the shit with somebody from Gwar?
Fucking, after being here last year to where we were interviewing them today, no.
Yeah.
Not at all.
Hear us, world. We are roaring like Katy Perry, man. So we're here and we're not going.
And talking to him, we tried to get on their
wavelength
with, you know, being astral beings, but
Yeah, I know I asked a couple stupid questions that he kind of dinged me on, and it was just sort of like, ah. That's really kind of the thing. I think we really needed to plan that one out a little bit more. But, you know, we didn't know who we would be talking to.
Yeah, we don't know who we're going to be talking to. And really, I want to give a shout out to John Freeman, the promoter, the publicist, the one who assisted us putting all this together today.
He was a great help, and he was pretty patient with us when we were running over. So thank you, John. And you, I think, were over there talking to Blothar, and I didn't see who the other guy was. So you probably did not meet Sean the Butcher, which we did. So we also want
Sirius XM.
Yeah, from Liquid Metal. So we got to chat with him. So I just want to give a shout to Sean the Butcher.
He loves wrestling.
You think?
Yeah, just a little bit.
All right. So then, after that, we missed. Yeah, actually, we skipped over Mutoid Man. We're going all out of order here. Just fuck it, you know, sue us. We saw Mutoid Man on one of the small stages, and
talk about fucking coming out like a cannon blast.
Yeah, I was really impressed with how heavy they were. Whoa, stay on the road. They were pretty fucking heavy. I mean, you know, they're more of like sort of a psychedelic, slightly doomish kind of retro thing when you listen to the album. But they fucking ripped our faces off live, man.
Fucking amazing energy.
And
great from the start.
And as soon as I walked over there and was started taking a couple of pictures, I'm looking at the singer and I'm like, Dan? Is that you, Dan, from Nine Circles? Well, I swear, they could have been fucking twins.
Yep.
So, Dan, admit it. You and Mutoid Man.
Very, very fun interview that you will hear or have heard.
I haven't even heard it yet.
Yeah.
I wasn't there for that.
Very fun. Jimmy Bauer of Down and I Hate God makes a quick appearance. You know, we talked about everything. From video games to plans for Mutoid Man, so I had a lot of fun during that. And I proceeded to hang out backstage with them, have a couple brews, you know.
Talk to Phil Anselmo.
Yeah, talk to Phil. We talked to Redskins. I know he's a Saints fan, but, you know, we talked about what he thought about RG3 and the Redskins this coming year. Highlight of my fucking metal existence there.
You know, I'm looking at the set list here, and I just realized we missed Dead Earth Politics, which was kind of a bummer because I wanted to see them because they're pretty cool. So, yeah, you know, everybody out there, at least you have an opportunity to check them out. Pretty sure they're on Bandcamp. Will, what did you think of Mutoid Man?
Mutoid Man?
Yeah.
I have to say that when I listen to them on Bandcamp or iTunes, I was not sold on it.
Hold on.
However.
One Jay Dickinson.
Jay is on the phone.
Get that motherfucker on here.
Get that motherfucker on the phone. On the phone. Get that motherfucker on the phone.
Is this the California Burrito Concern?
This is the one.
Motherfucker!
You caught us in the middle of a post-cat.
Do you have a second to talk, Jay?
I do.
Okay, hey, Jay.
Wait, hold on.
First things first.
Fuck you. First of all, Jay, can you hear me? This is Will.
I hear you loud and clear, my friend.
Yeah, fuck you because they've called me Jay God knows how many times today. Go fuck yourself.
I only did it once.
I love you. I love you, and I want a burrito right now.
I love you, John.
Okay. I'm sorry, man. They got Jay on the brain, buddy. It's hard to beat.
I know. It is hard to beat. Yeah. I beat often every day, but it's hard to beat.
We even called him Jay during the Goatwhore interview.
I literally, within 22 seconds of being in this car, and then another 5 minutes in this car, fucking Buke called me Jay.
Twice.
T-
Dwight, yeah.
I love you, Duke. Yep.
I made it all the way to the Goatwhore interview before I did it.
Yeah.
Well, hey, you know what? Keep it something in mind, dude. When I get down there and he sees me in person, there's a very good chance he'll call me Will.
Yeah.
Well, he actually has a new name now. We call him Beefstick the Chewy.
Nice.
Yeah,
he's the new member of Gwar, Beefstick the Chewy. We'll explain that later.
So, what time is it over there, Jay? 1 o'clock in the afternoon?
Or six?
I felt so bad about that. I really did. But yeah, shit, I don't know what it is, 6 here or something. So it's what, 9 by you? Are you guys driving home?
Yay, you got it.
It's 12:24 here in Zurich time or whatever time zone we're in.
Jay's a little time zone challenged. We were supposed to record a podcast yesterday, but...
Watch out. Vehicle stopped.
Yeah, I fucked up.
But he fucked up.
Am I like on speaker?
Yes, yeah. You're on Bluetooth for everybody to hear.
So we're recording you. We're recording you, too.
Yesterday.
Yeah.
Well, we were supposed to record at 6 o'clock. Wait, I can't even remember now, except that I did the math backwards. I was like, fuck yeah, that's 9 o'clock. I can finally drink some beer with these guys. But it wasn't 9 o'clock. Well, it was 3 o'clock.
Yeah. Yeah, that's
so
all right.
I'm watching the latest Pixar movie, and these guys are thinking I'm dead on the road somewhere.
It's just like,
my phone or nothing.
All I can think about is what time are the burritos fresh out in California? That's all you're thinking about. You know
they're always fresh.
We had sushi over here tonight. No burritos, Will.
Wait, so. Tell me this. How is the California Burrito Concern LLC doing?
Just breaking it in, my brother. I've been on vacation for 2 weeks, and I shit you not, I probably had 4 burritos in those 2 weeks. I eat a lot of fucking burritos, dude.
He loves the burritos.
So my stock is always high.
So, Jay.
Jay, can I just tell you that? I've been brutalized all day. These motherfuckers have been calling me Jay all day. Like, literally. I'm in the car for 3 seconds. These fuckers call me Jay.
Thank you for the compliment, man.
Well, from now on, he's going to be Beefstick the Chewy, so that shouldn't be a problem.
They're like, he's so handsome, so I just keep mistaking him for Jay.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
You are in the car now, correct? You guys are driving home?
Yeah, we're driving home.
Three of us are in the car. We're going.
Or basically, since he's shit-faced, you can call Will Matt.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait, hold on. That is definitely not entirely correct. Buke.
Well, no, I'll call Buke, and you're Matt.
Wait, just call Buke shitface because he's driving us home, and I'm way. I can honestly say I think I'm way more sober than Buke, who's driving us.
Oh,
Buke's just fine.
I'm fine.
Are you serious?
Fine. Yeah, I'm fine.
Somebody tell me what the highlight was. I need to know.
Gosh.
Troglodyte
was definitely a highlight.
Really?
Valkyrie was a highlight. Goatwhore was a highlight.
No, actually, talking to Ben from
Goatwhore,
like, unbelievable, like, just a regular dude. Like, that was a ridiculously fun interview.
Being told to fuck off by Beefcake the Mighty.
Yeah, I love those fucking guys. Did you answer my questions, Duke?
I asked, I tried with Goatwhore. I asked one of them, but as you will hear when you hear the interview, there was very little talk about anything music related at all.
You talked about monster trucks and tires, and it was great.
Even though I sent you the question, I knew you'd get rolling. I was like, I don't know why I'm sending these questions to him. He thinks he's not going to have anything to ask him, but I knew you would just roll with it.
It's not like he can read them.
Did you guys all go back? Because it looked like you were all back there.
Yeah. Buke did...
So everybody was involved.
Buke was solo for Mutoid Man.
George, I want to know what George was...
He was. George, what did you like best?
I liked hanging with these guys the best.
He liked the burrito stand.
But, you know, everything.
George, no, George, what George liked the best was finding any available fucking shade.
Yes.
If there was a 2-foot sign casting an inch by inch square of shade, George was standing in it.
I'm smart.
But it's brutal out there, dude. I know you got it.
George was a trooper, but a big pussy at the same time. Like, what? He was a big pussy. If we did not force him to go and watch the show, like, he was like, I just want shade. But he was a trooper, so
dude,
99% of the time he was baking the sun and being completely miserable. There was 5% of the time, 5% or less of the time, that he was hiding out in the shade and we had to go find him. He was a trooper.
I went and sat down.
It's always cool here. It's always 70 degrees. So when I come from Death Fest, I'll probably be sitting in the shade with George. It's never over 80 here, dude. It's hot today, and it's like 79 degrees. And I'm like,
what?
Fuck, it's hot.
Oh, fuck you, Jay. 79 degrees.
It was like 95 here today.
Hey, Will. Fuck you, Will.
I have to defend my honor here. I only went and sat down for like the first 2 songs of Clutch, and then I went back out because I was sitting there recuperating briefly, and then I saw Matt from yesterday's Saints walk by with Will, and so I got up and I ran my fat ass over there to catch up with you guys.
I trotted.
George, you never have to defend your honor to me because I know everything these guys are saying is full of shit anyway. You don't have to tell me that.
No. Literally one time I saw George sort of running. It was funny.
That was to get into the Gwar interview.
It's funny because he's fat.
It was a fast walk.
George is doing the perpetual truffle shuffle.
Dude, truffle shuffle. That is him. He tried to run and it was so ridiculously funny.
I'm gonna get in shape and I'm gonna kick all your asses.
Except
Jay.
Hold on.
So when are you gonna fuck those porn stars?
What's that
again?
That's not gonna happen.
I don't know. Keep talking, Jay.
So I gotta say, Will, thanks for enjoying Cold Hard because I love those guys. And I know Duke's not too crazy about it, but George might like them, I think.
I do.
You totally represented with the Pig Destroyer shirt today too. That was awesome.
Thank you, sir. But no, seriously.
I love those boys.
Like the Goatwhore guys. Like I will say this.
Monster trucks.
Man, I'll be the first one to admit, like, talking to some of these bands today that, especially Ben from Goatwhore, like, I love Goatwhore, and I've seen Soylent Green, and I knew that the lead singer of Goatwhore and Soylent Green is the same guy. I did not know his name is Ben. Regardless of that, we were at this interview. He was the coolest fucking goddamn dude ever.
Same monster trucks.
And, like, literally, we were talking, like, half the time we were talking about monster trucks.
There it is.
And, like, it was one of the most organic, the best way I can describe it is the most organic interviews because we just talked about
monster trucks.
Yeah, like, whatever we want to talk about. Whatever he wanted to talk about, that's what we riffed on. It was awesome.
Can I guarantee you something? I guarantee you he enjoyed it more than a lot of the interviews he does then, dude.
Exactly.
Because they can answer the same fucking questions over and over.
Exactly.
So I can't wait to hear him.
And that's exactly
what... I'll kind of say something real quick, too, which was, Duke, I saw your fill-in-fill-in picture.
Yes, sir.
You're weak in the knees?
Dude. Even though Phil was fucking 9,000 miles to fucking outer space,
So was Buke, actually. In fact, he had to get plowed to do the Mutoid Man solo and talking to those guys. And so then afterwards, when he came out to watch Down, he spent the whole set trying to convince us that Phil Anselmo was in the top three and then the top five vocalists in heavy metal. And it's not that he was trying to convince us. It's that he kept trying to convince us the whole fucking set.
Because
like, he'd try and do that, and then...
Like, oh, just singing a lyric or two.
Yeah, and then he'd turn around and just start all over again, because he'd completely forgotten that he'd already made this argument. So, but
I mean, am I wrong here, guys? No, he's not the greatest man.
Fucking...
But I'm happy for you, dude.
I will fucking say it again. Phil Anselmo, top five greatest metal frontman of all time. Maybe top three. Most influential? He Tom. Has to be in top
Most
three.
Under the influence?
Tom Araya.
Okay, Jay, you know what fucking Will says?
Jay Dickinson.
He says Jay Tom Dickinson. Of Slayer Tom is more important than Phil of Pantera is.
Well, hey, I'm saving all my argument juice for the Maiden argument, so that's between...
Oh, dude! Yeah. Jay, we've had... Dude,
now, this is for later.
I'm saving up my juice, dude.
This is for later.
I gotta save it, because I gotta come out swinging. When we said that, okay. Maiden left,
hey.
I can't be...
Dude, you're swinging and missing, buddy. I already know your opinion. Swinging and missing.
No, we'll see. We'll see. Okay. I'm not having an argument now.
We were ready to hear his opinion at 1 o'clock in the morning yesterday or whatever. Whatever time it was.
What time zone were you in, Jay?
This is an imaginary one at this point.
Yeah, exactly. Hey, so basically we interviewed Troglodyte, I interviewed Mutoid Man, we did the Goatwhore.
We talked to Tony Gwar, from Municipal Waste.
We talked to Tony from Municipal Waste, we did Gwar.
Valkyrie.
Municipal Waste, they're good too. Was that the closest you've ever stood to Phil?
Aside from being on the railing at his shows, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that was the closest. All right, cool. Yeah. Well, did you, I didn't hear you say anything about the Down set. You didn't say that was like one of your...
It was amazing. It was fucking amazing. The songs that they played were hit or miss early on, but fucking Down.
You know, when he came
did
out...
Did you hear him, or did you just talk to him?
Oh, I talked to him.
He just talked to him. He didn't interview him.
Phil was kind of secluded in his own little, like,
douchebag world.
No, like extra VIP room.
But when Buke came out from having met him, he was, first of all, he was grinning ear to ear.
His dick was hard.
And he was like, if he would have stood still long enough, I would have ripped his pants off and sucked his dick.
Of course.
Well, you look, I can tell you this. I can't tell if Phil himself is thrilled in the picture or not. But you didn't ask him. I know you didn't ask him one extremely important question, Duke, which is, where do I get my fucking LP copy of Noah?
Yeah, good point.
Yeah, man. Maybe he had one in his suitcase. He could have hooked you up.
Well, if Phil could have fucking opened his eyes and fucking seen clearly through all his through all his fucking pills and marijuana smoke...
Top five.
Hey, excusing his behavior, you cannot fucking say Phil Anselmo is not influential for American metal. For metal in general.
You dumbed it down a shade there. You dumbed it down a shade. You didn't go for numbers. You just said, I can't say he's not influential. I agree with you there. Yeah. I'm not going to put a number on it.
What you may...
I feel like it was a top three.
No, because I know what you're going to say. You're going to say, oh, Bruce and Dio and Halford.
No, not Halford. He's a great singer, but I don't know that he's an amazing front man. Guy just kind of stands there like a fucking tree, dude. Especially now, he's got a cane.
Phil Anselmo commands the fucking stage. He does. Yes.
I would have loved to have been there. I would have loved to have seen him. And you know what? I have no doubt he kicked as much ass as you say he did. And they did. And everybody did.
He's always stoned out of his fucking gourd. Always. It's fucking Philly and so. Do I need to fucking keep saying it, George?
No, I think we're good. I think we're good on that.
Get some fucking excitement. God.
I know it's not Nile or anything, but fuck.
Who was your best interview?
Dude, by the way, Nile, fucking love Nile.
We're talking to them tomorrow.
We'll talk to him tomorrow.
You told the boys we're talking to. We're looking forward to that, dude. But who was your best interview today?
So the three of us were not on every interview because Buke was the man. But I have to say, Ben from Gohor, it was literally just like having a crazy conversation. Not even crazy. It was just like sitting down and BSing with a friend of yours.
A friend of yours who you already had gotten out weeks or months of BS chit chat.
Yeah,
that, you know.
It was fun. Yeah. It was literally fun.
And I'm sure I believe he's that cool, but isn't he also a badass looking motherfucker? Dude, he looks like the singer from Goatwhore, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Well, you know what's
But what's funny is though, all the time seeing Goatwhore prior, you see him with the big leather bracers on.
Yeah.
It was weird seeing him just like sitting down at the table without that shit on.
Yeah. Yeah, I almost didn't recognize him.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think, George, he's got to be our age, too, dude. Or close to
he's 42. He is. So yeah, he's 42.
A long time ago.
Yeah, no. He's younger than me. He's 1973.
Now?
Yeah. No, we talked about this. He's 1973, so he is slightly younger than me. I'm 72. 1972.
Oh, I'm 71, so... George,
you're 71.
Right?
I'm
71 as well. Yeah.
What about Mutoid Man? Did you guys watch them?
No, they're old like you. They're 1970.
Mutoid Man came out like a fucking cannon blast. Jay,
they ripped faces, man.
Fucking amazing.
I knew they were gonna be good live.
They were amazing live. My interview with them. Since I didn't have like all the history and stuff, and you know they're not an upstart band, but they're kind of on our radar. They're only going back a couple months. I kind of went into it a little in the dark, but it played off well. You know, you wouldn't have.
Yeah, because I knew these guys, so I don't know that well, but I do know. One of them was in Converted and one of them was in Caden, which I didn't realize until very recently. So they're kind of a little super group there, man. But they don't sound like either of those bands to me.
No.
But yeah, I watched that video you sent me, Buke, actually. So I knew they were going to just fucking bling it live.
Yeah,
you know?
They fucking.
But they're like a slightly popular band for them, if you ask me.
Yeah, in a sense. And they're playing under this, like I told them, they were under this gazebo kind of. Like where you picture like where public parks have cookouts and stuff, like a covered structure, and they just came out in the. This was like a little third stage.
Okay, all right, okay, go ahead. Sorry,
and they just came out right at the start, and you would have thought they were on the main stage with the energy that they fucking had.
Cool. Yeah, they're here in about a week. I want to see them down here, so I'm totally excited for that show.
Yeah, you have
to. They're coming with Wild Throne.
Yeah, I asked them about that. They were totally cool, but they're big fans of them. You have to go see them live, Jay.
All right. Oh, no, I already got my ticket. It's in a small place here, too. Well, my ticket, I think, was $15. I don't remember, but it was cheap.
They were so...
I'm totally psyched, man.
Yeah, they were so easy to talk to. I'm sure you could go talk to... Steve, the singer, and mention Metalheads podcast, and he'd fucking talk to you just like they talked to me. They were so fucking cool.
Actually, you know what? That's just what I'm gonna fucking do, dude. You know, they just as a shout out because I love those guys. Their vinyl is cheap on their site. They have like a vinyl package where you get like both records and a T-shirt. It's super cheap, dude.
Yeah, fucking, they were awesome. Will kind of went off, networking with his brewer buddies, so I don't think he saw fucking down.
No,
he did. He was there with me.
I saw more down than you saw down.
No, you
I did.
No, actually, we all saw about the same amount because we came and saw them after interviewing.
You were interviewing people, and George and I saw down.
I was at the fucking front taking pictures with my photo pass. Bitches.
They got some really... Oh, yeah, a photo pass here, and that's badass. guys took beautiful pictures, did everything up on the Twitter looks like a pro shot. Like, no shit. Like, they all enjoyed this. George put up a good bunch of videos of Gwar. They, I was going to ask you a question about, what the fuck was it? Shit.
About Will? Yeah, he's fucking trashed.
Oh, no, actually, it wasn't about that. It was about, was the Gwar guy really that good? You guys said it was good.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
But I didn't. Yeah,
why don't you ask fucking Will here, who stole fucking 2 4-packs?
Yeah, he just walked out.
Do you know those guys, Will?
Yeah,
he did
know.
Today.
Yeah. At the end of the, he's back there stuffing his face with chocolate. It smells like. But at the end, when we were getting ready to walk out, he just walked into one of the beer brewery guys. He walks in, comes out like 3 minutes later with 2 4-packs and a beef stick, you know, like a beef jerky stick. And so that's why he's now called Beef Stick the Chewy.
I want to know where the fuck that beef stick is.
It's
probably in the back.
It's probably in the back somewhere.
The girls were fucking... the girls were glorious. I kept falling in love over and over and over again. The bands were...
Who is that chick that you put a picture up with you?
That's Samantha Mack.
Is that the one that you interviewed a while back?
Yep. Yeah,
she's the MC of the show.
She's the MC. She's a porn star. I just think she's pretty cool, so...
Well, where are you guys? Like, how far? I'm going to drive into it.
Like, an hour and a half?
Yeah, a couple hours.
That's nothing, dude. Dude, it takes an hour and a half to go get a hamburger here.
Jay.
Hey, Jay. Yes, sir.
This is Will speaking, by the way. Like, so how long is it until you make the jump to the LLC, the California Burrito Concern? How long is it until you actually make the jump to make it a reality, the California Burrito Concern?
I don't think they'll ever be as good as they are in my
dude!
I hope you shared that letter with John, by the way.
Sorry. I have to, like, lick a lot of puss's ears here to actually make the... Yeah, so...
What?
Like, you
lick the octopus's ear?
Lick a lot of puss. That's you.
Jay, tomorrow, when we do this fucking Nile, are you going to be on track with the time and everything?
Yeah, I will be there 3 hours ahead of time, like, really staring at my computer. Trust me, I will.
Wait. So, Jay.
You already know I feel guilty, but I got it right now. It's 3 your time, noon my time. I'll be sitting at 1:30.
And I'm going to be at my house, and George is going to be at... Hey, we're all going to be on Skype.
Skype?
Yeah. No, but, hey, Jay.
Just hit puberty.
Jay, like, I fucking love Nile. Like...
I wish you could sit in on this one, dude.
I wish I could, too, but these two douchebags are not Nile fans.
I am.
No, you're not.
Well, I think George liked the new record.
You
we've got the new record, bro. Somebody
should
hook you up.
You know what? All I've heard is you guys talking about, I got the new Nile promo. I got the new Nile promo. I did not get the new Nile promo. Somebody please fucking send me the Nile promo.
George?
Okay.
Alright. I actually have a picture of Carl Sanders drinking my beer. Do you guys have that fucking picture?
Yeah, it's hanging up in my house.
Yeah, go fuck yourselves. Send me the goddamn new Nile promo. I'm a bigger Nile fan than you fuck faces.
Colonel Sanders?
I'm putting on my mailing list, but I promise.
Hey, how did you get that Infira Bruno stuff or Bruo stuff?
Yeah, what's up with that? I guess Neutrino likes you better.
I'll tell you why I do have a theory, and it's not meant to be insulting, but okay, so he said it. I did talk to him a couple times. He's like, hey, send me your address. This is just via Facebook after we signed it up. And I was like, yeah, send me yours too. And then I was like, what's that? You sent me a premium, but just like maybe the first day that we talked to him. And then I think I heard from him once the next day.
But here's my insulting, but not necessarily on purpose, really.
Here comes the fat.
They're waiting to have your sizes on the
t-shirt. They don't have your size, fat boy.
Yours either.
Are you calling Jay fat? Like, really?
I don't have... I gave him my address yesterday.
I'm sure it would be. He was probably like, large, no problem. What have you done at your bastards? They'd be like, holy shit. Well, you have to wait for those boys.
Yep. Good luck with that.
So, but I'm sending him a CD on Monday, too. I mean, I don't know. It doesn't matter if he never listens to it, but I'll send him some shit, too, because we just got guitar picks and stuff. But yeah, man, I'm not holding my flag. It's too bad. You guys, I don't know why nobody likes you guys, but I guess they just don't. You know how it is.
When's the fucking Catatonic Society, like, shirts coming? What are we waiting for?
That's a similar story. I gotta get some larger sizes, bro.
Fuck you.
I got a new design coming. I really do. It's cool. It's a cool new design. I'll send it to you. I also got guitar picks.
I don't play guitar. I don't play guitar.
Okay. He just plays a skin flute.
This is my friend's band. Oh, yeah. They're cool, dude. They're fucking cool. I love them. It's the first band guitar pick I've ever had.
Oh. Aren't you fucking special?
Oh, yeah. I gotta go. I'm out here just walking circles around the park while I go back and watch a movie with my wife. But, George, I just want to say, Georgie, you're so quiet. I love you, George.
Love you too, buddy.
Jay.
All right.
Jay,
yeah.
You better fucking come out here at the year-end episode, or otherwise I will fucking kick your ass.
Yeah, I heard that rumor. I don't think I can make it happen, but we got to pick that date. I know it's hard, but we got to pick that date.
Wait, why do we pick a date? No. You're coming out for an entire week.
You can never ask Will to pick a date because he has fucking guard duty or whatever, reserve duty.
Not my guard duty. I fucking kill people for a living. Not like these two douchebags. And not like you, so do not ask me to pick a fucking date. I will do it when I can do it, and you will do it when I tell you to fucking do it. You understand me, Jay?
But you don't do that stuff on Christmas time, do you?
Dude, he's always killing people.
Dude, I kill people year round. You guys, like, these guys ask me, where did you go during the GWARBQ? I kill 5 people.
Blood's on his hands. Jay.
And on his shirt.
We'll fucking talk to you tomorrow, brother.
That you will. Hey, pick me a date. We'll work on it with you, dude, because I do want to come. I'm coming to death test, you know that.
But you're coming to the year end. You're coming to the year end podcast. You promised.
If I can have a 1 month. Even just lead time on the date, I'll be there.
No. Fucking horseshit. You said... No, fuck you. You said you were coming to the year-end podcast. I don't give a shit about... like, Death Fest.
I don't know about my Death Fest picks. But you know what? I will promise you Will right now.
This is a slippery slope, Jay.
Yeah. Jay, if you do not, I will fucking pull out piano wire and kill you.
And then fuck you in the ass.
100%.
Okay. Sorry.
If I say I'm going to do it with the mild exception of time zones, I'll be there.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. We will Skype you tomorrow, Jake. See you, buddy.
I love you guys.
See ya.
Bye.
Later.
See ya.
All right, then. Where were we? I dropped my phone, so I can't figure out where... I don't know. There was only a couple more bands left. After Down, there was Clutch. We sort of talked about that a little bit.
Yeah.
And then after...
I left again. I had another interview to do.
Yeah, and then...
How big are boobs or hers?
Mutoid? No, that was Valkyrie.
I will admit, I was so busy, I didn't even get to see a lot of boobs.
Too busy for boobs.
You were a busy guy.
Yep. Drove all the way down here for fucking what?
For what?
For
to talk to
Gwar,
to talk to Troglodyte, to talk to
Goatwhore, the animals.
To talk to go fuck yourself.
Yep.
Like, okay. Are you serious? Are you really complaining?
No, I'm not.
Because you're
all right. So then after that, Gwar came on the Scum Dog stage, and you know, what's to say? It was Gwar. It was bloody. It was bloody good.
Now, Will's shirt, I noticed after we met back up with him, because I did not see him with you during Gwar. Where were you at, Will, and how did your shirt get the fucking blood on it? Where were you at?
Yeah, did you get up front somehow? You must have.
There's a thing called Gwar blood. And if you are anywhere in the vicinity of Gwar and you get it on you, it and you have a white shirt, you get Gwar blood on you. I don't know where the fuck you guys were.
No, well, that was cryptic.
You're not answering the question. Where were you at?
Did you get down front? Where
yeah, yeah, of course I did. Okay. Like, where were you guys?
I was off to the side.
Taking pictures. That's where I got mine. George and his black on black. George is fine.
I didn't want to ruin my Darth Vader metal shirt. I got a lot of compliments on this shirt today.
The entire day today, Buke was being the man. Like, Buke was always interviewing people. And so it was mostly George and I hanging out all day.
Like buddies.
Yeah. Oh, and we were buddies. But you have to understand that sometimes George just wants to go find some shade, and then
I did not do that once.
Yep, I believe it.
No, are you kidding me? Like,
well, if we were, like,
you remember that drone that was flying in the sky during Gwar? Yeah. George was trying to
It's casting a shadow. I need to get under that. Oh my god!
But if we were walking around the vendors and stuff, and there was shade to be had, sure, I'd stand in it. No. I'm not fucking stupid.
No, there was a point when right by the water tent, there was that sign. Remember you stood right by that little sign that was casting maybe knee-high shadow?
No, I remember that.
Yeah, it was early on in the day.
Well, yeah, if we were there and there was shade, I stood in it. I'm not stupid.
You know what's sad is you're an enormous person, and then most people were trying to
hide
behind your shade, and you were like, oh no, I'm trying to create my own shade. And then all these other people were like clamoring at your ankles because
see the abuse I take.
We're just like a redwood tree.
Yes,
it's like a redwood, but for other reasons.
George is a tree ant.
All right, well, I don't need to take this shit. I'm sorry. It's what happens when you're the nice guy. I'm the nice guy. I take a lot of shit. But that's okay. I love these guys. I know they do it out of love and a complete lack of respect.
But seriously, Will.
Sorry.
But where were you at during Gwar?
I was watching Gwar. I actually was up on the roof of one of the pavilions for a while.
But how did you get the blood? I know it fucking squirts out far, but
you just get near the stage, and when you see all your friends who were up closer to the
all his
than
beer
you,
guys again.
Yeah.
The ones who you know he drove with and you know drove him down there in their Priuses.
Yeah. And anyway. So
if you know enough, this is actually a very interesting concert for me because I literally saw so many there was a guy I went to brewing school with, Cade Miller, who drove all the way up from Alabama, and I saw him at the concert tonight. Yeah.
Who was the guy as we were interviewing Goatwhore?
John Basella.
Okay.
Like a super nice dude. He writes for the Vinyl District. Super awesome, cool dude. Love that guy. I see him all the time at concerts and stuff. So as far as brewing, so Cigar City, the brewery down in Tampa, Florida, they made the beer for Gwar. So I got to hang out with those guys.
How long it took for him to fucking
get to the point?
Yeah, weasel his way in there with those guys. Remember, we saw Tony. Tony was talking to those guys. Will quickly weaseled his way in there, and then we were sucking second fiddle the whole rest of the day, George.
Yep.
Wait.
Well, yeah.
I wanted to mention something, too. Unfortunately, I didn't catch the guy's name, but there was a photographer guy that Matt Rice from Yesterday's Saints knew. He's an older guy, and he was there taking pictures. And I couldn't quite catch the name of who he was shooting for, but Matt introduced me to him, and he's a real nice guy. And he was like, man, you know, the three stages, I'm fucking running my ass off trying to, you know. The same problem we had. He's like, it's physically impossible for me to shoot every band because there's always, you know, half the time
you
there's
get three songs, the first three, and they're already done with one by the time you get there.
And like, you know, a lot of the time there were two bands playing at the same time. You know, the farther away big stage and then the little stage would play at the same time because you could listen to the small stage and not hear the big stage and vice versa.
Yep.
So yeah, it was like physically impossible, and he was just like, "Oh, I can't wait to get out of here." And what was funny is that I then saw him during Gwar, and he came out, and he was coming from the pit out, and he was just plastered in the blood. So I hope he's relaxing now. All right, so yeah, Gwar was awesome, and then. After that, surprisingly, Gwar did not close the show.
Yeah.
The Descendants actually closed the show.
Sorry, I was
wondering what you... But I will say this. You know who stole the show? Clutch.
Yes, you mentioned that.
Yeah.
Right. But why?
Because Clutch, no matter what... You could be in an outdoor arena. You could be at the 930 Club in Washington, D.C. You could be in your basement in Frederick, Maryland. These guys sound phenomenal. They destroyed it. They sounded perfect. They sounded phenomenal. I'm a huge Clutch fan, but the reason why I am a huge Clutch fan is this is the only second time I've ever seen them live. Unbelievable. They just sound phenomenally live.
Has that singer lost some weight?
Nah, he looks about the same.
Actually, I would say he actually gained weight. He's got a big belly on it. Yeah, Neil's got a big belly on him now.
He looks way smaller than the pictures I've seen.
Well, compared to the two of you guys, yeah. He's,
man, he's a slender reed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, so yeah, the Descendants...
He's not driving a Prius.
No.
The Descendants closed the show. I was pretty much the only one of us that wanted to see them. I've never seen them before. And, you know, it was cool. They sounded good for what it was. For why they closed the show, I do not know. Maybe. I have no fucking idea why they did. But
I think we were all like, okay, well, Gwar played and Clutch played. Why? Who are these guys? Okay, are we ready to go? Let's go.
Yeah, I could care less.
Yeah. So, but, you know, all in all, I think it was a good day. It was a successful day.
Oh, fuck yeah.
It was a fucking blast, gentlemen.
Yeah.
A troop. Fuck all around. Start to fit from the drive down to, you know, the moment we got there. This day has been a fucking blast.
Sure has.
Sorry we haven't done this fucking sooner.
Yeah.
Other shows or just hanging out more in general.
Yep.
This has just been a fucking blast.
Oh, but this has been a pure pleasure.
We had awesome interviews. We, you know,
met awesome cool bands. People. Yeah, and, met a lot of really cool people.
Yeah.
Anyone that we haven't mentioned that we talked to, sorry, we're stupid. But
we handed out a bunch of cards.
Yeah, we enjoyed it. People. And we enjoyed talking to you. And is that a... Nah. I was like, is that a rebel flag?
Yeah.
Sure fucking is. Huh. Hanging on the side of the highway on 95 in Virginia. All right, well, I think this is a good place to wrap it up. All right, we are out of here. If you haven't heard the interviews yet, you will be now. Until next time, this is George.
And Buke.
And Will.
Of the Metalheads podcast.